Ford of Canada. At Ford, quality is job one. Driving is believing. By CP Rail, helping Canada move forward. And your local Petro-Canada dealers and agents, putting Canada first. CFL 84, the very best in professional football entertainment. Along with the game, we'll bring you complete news, highlights, and features from the CFL. Now, for all the action, let's join our CBC sports crew.
Hello, I'm Brian Williams. Welcome to CFL 84. Today, the BC Lions and the Concorde from Montreal's Olympic Stadium. Big game for the Lions as they try to move into sole possession of first place in the West. They are currently tied with Winnipeg. BC with a game in hand. Bombers, by the way, home tonight to Dieter Brock and the Ticats. Hey, Calgary's on the move with the win last night over the Ottawa Rough Riders. As we look at the Eastern standings, the Rough Riders lost to Calgary, means Montreal today looking to move into sole possession of second place. And right now, from the Olympic Stadium in Montreal, here's Don Whitman. All right, thank you, Don Whitman. We apologize. Apparently, some areas not receiving audio from Montreal. Coming up at halftime, Barb McLeod will drop by. She talks with BC Lions guard Glenn Leonard. I'll take a look at first half highlights, bring you up to date from this week in the CFL, including the Stampeders come from behind win last night at McMahon Stadium. The opening kickoff is up next as CFL 84 continues from the Olympic Stadium in Montreal.
Parkinson's disease can make an adult more helpless than a child. It hits one in every 200 Canadians over the age of 40. If you think it could be you or someone in your family, contact the Parkinson Foundation for help.
Sunday on CBC Television. Neighbors bringing you a load of laughs.
Morning, neighbors.
The people next door are kind of strange.
Media.
But it looks like they're here to stay. R.H. Thompson and Harvey Atkin are neighbors.
What do you want?
Living side by side in a comedy of urban survival.
What are you doing?
The neighborhood will never be the same. Neighbors, Sunday night on CBC Television.
Back at Olympic Stadium in Montreal as the Concorde prepare to kick off to the British Columbia Lions to get this game underway. And the Montreal Concorde have a great opportunity this afternoon to take over sole possession of second place in the Eastern Conference following the loss last night by the Ottawa Rough Riders. The Rough Riders losing by a single point to the Calgary Stampeders. A cool afternoon in Montreal. Skies are overcast and there is the possibility of some rain before this game concludes. British Columbia Lions, as we mentioned, looking for a club record 7th consecutive victory. The two teams met on July 28th at the stadium at BC Place, and British Columbia won that game by a score of 22-7. The Concord come into this game after a two-week layoff, and they also have two games in hand on the Ottawa Rough Riders. So this is a big game for Joe Gallant and company.
Every time they can win right now, it gets them closer to getting that playoff spot, and really that's what it's all about. So, you know, the opportunity is there. It's up to them.
David Tolu'umu takes the ball at the 20-yard line, and he returns the kickoff to the 31. A kickoff of 48 yards by Jerry McGrath and a return of 14 by Tolu'umu. And John Pointer was downfield to make the tackle. Tolu'umu, because his sweater was stolen, will be wearing number 25 this afternoon. The receiving corps with Ned Armour in there in place of Sandusky, who is on the reserve list, and the offensive line. And at halftime, we might point out that Glenn Leonhard, who is playing that guard spot, will be featured at halftime. A pass intended for Mervin Fernandez. It was deflected, and it will be 2nd and 10 for the Lions.
They're starting out right away, Don, trying to get the ball to Fernandez, and we saw what he did last year against these same Concord. There were 3 touchdown passes thrown to him, and I don't think he was touched one time by a defensive back. He caught them clean and ran for touchdowns.
John Pointer, the new addition at that linebacking position. Pointer, of course, previously has played in the CFL with Edmonton, Toronto, and Winnipeg. Penalty flag on the play. Fernandez, I'm sure, was offside. A hit on the far side of the field as Pankratz takes the pass and is belted by Harry Skipper, and Pankratz felt that one as he is very slow in getting to his feet on the far side of the field. But I believe over on the opposite side of the field, Mervin Fernandez jumped offside.
Well, that's certainly what it appeared to be, but I'll tell you one thing, that is
a
great hit.
He knocked him all the way back to the national anthem.
Referee Lauren Woods sorting things out, and because Pankratz almost got the first down, the Concord will take the penalty.
BC 24, 2nd down repeated.
So it will be 2nd and 15 now for the British Columbia Lions. They were just a half a yard short of a first down, and I think they may have gambled at that particular position on 3rd down.
I think they would have there because they had about a yard to go, but right now 2nd and 15, this is a big one.
Jacques Chapdelaine is in there taking Pankratz's place, so Pankratz is taking a rest on the sidelines from that hit.
Roy DeWalt setting up the screen over the middle, and they are stopped well short of the first down as Paul Gray from his linebacking position came in to pin John Henry White. So the BC Lions are unable to move the ball on their first offensive series, and they are forced into a punting situation as Lou Pisaglia comes into the ball game, and that is a decided advantage for any team that has one man handling both the place kicking and the punting chores.
Especially to do it so well. Pisaglia punts with anybody in the league, and he's such an excellent field goal kicker that he has an advantage over, I believe, both of Montreal's kickers.
And it also, of course, gives you an extra spot on the roster.
Which you always look for, always. Every extra spot, you can sure use it.
And the time count violation against the British Columbia Lions, as they took too long in launching the 3rd down kick, so they move 5 yards further back. So the Montreal Concord could get the ball in reasonable field
time
position
count violation
for their first offensive series.
BC number 5, 3rd down repeated.
Don, the Montreal team defensively has been just as strong as anybody throughout the season, but they've had some changes in their linebacking corps. Paul Gray in the middle linebacker spot and John Pointer new in there, relatively new. And this may take its toll because you have to have those linebackers pretty well groomed in there in this game.
Zaglia did a good job of fielding that low snap. Preston Young on the punt return to the 47-yard line. That was a 40-yard kick by Lou Pisaglia, a run back of 9 yards. And Ron Robinson, the ex-Concord, was downfield to make the tackle. Denny Ferdinand back in the lineup for the Montreal Concord, number 34, after sitting out the last game. Turner Gill, the starting quarterback. They have Terry Lyman back there in the backfield, along with Dwayne Wilson. Bailey has moved from a wide receiver position to a slot back post. Rollout action, Turner Gill throwing complete for a first down to Bailey. And that takes the Concord to the 47-yard line. And he was stopped there by Larry Crawford. And this is what Joe Gallant told us Montreal would do, that rollout action with Turner Gill.
Well, he said they had to get the ball to their inside receivers, Bailey and Araki. Plus, he has to see the quarterback run with the football. They got the two import running backs in there, and they're going to try to run this football in D.C., I think because of the pressure that the Lions will exert on them throughout the afternoon.
First and 10 from the 47. They try and go inside with Terry Lyman. And he ran right into Glenn Jackson at the line of scrimmage.
Boy, that Glenn Jackson will hit you. We've seen him throughout the years just play some tremendous ball for the BC Lions. And getting back to the Montreal team, they will run with the football, but the quarterback is going to be the key. As far as Turner Gill is concerned, having a little bit of early success means a lot. A couple weeks ago against Hamilton, he started slowly and he ended slowly, so it's important that he starts off on a good note today.
Throwing over the middle, Meraki has the first down inside the 35-yard line. And as you said, Leo, it's important as far as the fortunes of the Concord are concerned that their young quarterback, Turner Gill, gets off to a good start. And by completing two passes, that has to be a confidence builder.
Well, one thing, Ron, that Coach Gallant was telling us before the game, as we see Turner go back here and set up, get the ball in there with a lot of authority, is that he can't get him to run with the football. And he's a great runner, but all of a sudden, when he gets to be a professional quarterback, he thinks he has to throw it all the time. There's another completion.
And it is Todd Brown making the catch on the far side of the field in front of Mal Bird. Brown a little disappointed with himself. He thought that he should have been able to pick up more yardage as he has a gain of 6. It will be 2nd and 4.
That's an excellent defensive play by Bird. And when Brown caught that football, he tried to spin real quick to the outside. And a lot of times you can get around that corner like that, but Bird got a good hold of it.
Well, the Montreal Concord have certainly had a number of injuries this year, particularly in the receiving corps. Todd Brown suffered a fractured cheekbone in training camp. Turner Gill gets away from the pressure. The pass incomplete. He was looking for Nick Araki, and Tyrone Cruz was defending and knocked it down. So it will be 3rd down, Montreal, and Don Sweet will come in to attempt the field goal. That defensive unit of the British Columbia Lions, the stingiest in the Canadian Football League. They have given up just 125 points this season. An even more impressive statistic, I believe, is the fact that they have yielded just 284 yards on an average per game. Field goal attempt by Don Sweet, and it is good. So the Montreal Concord leads the football game 3-0 with 10:30 remaining in the opening quarter.
Don't just think about it. Do it. Do it with a friend and you both can bend. Do it for your muscles, it'll make them hustle. Do it for your feet, it's kind of neat. Do it with some action, participation. Don't just think about it.
Do it.
Participation. Get with the action.
Well, certainly a contrast to the last time the teams met when the British Columbia Lions dominated play in the first half and went on to that 22-7 win. That game took place July 28th at BC Place Stadium. The Montreal Concord looking much more impressive on their first series of plays than they did in the entire game in their last outing against the Hamilton Tiger Cats.
Well, that's for sure. They really look stagnant against the Hamilton Tiger Cats, but as you say, they look like a better football team, and I think the big reason is Turner Gill has had some success. You know, an interesting thing, Don, is this Montreal team has got to be a tough team physically, but they're the least penalized team in the entire league, and the BC Lions are third highest penalized. That may mean something, that the BC Lions are playing a little bit more aggressively this year defensively than the Concord are.
Darnell Clash trying to get outside, and he is brought down at the 40-yard line by Paul Gray. Darnell Clash has that great speed, and he had a punt return for a touchdown a week ago against the Hamilton Tiger Cats. So the BC Lions will scrimmage 1st and 10, the ball at their own 40-yard line.
Roy DeWalt's in there at quarterback, Ron. How about his hands? Has he got some pretty good hands?
Oh, They're huge. He says he lifts a basketball, he can palm it with two fingers. So you know he's got some pretty big and strong hands.
That really helps on a bad day to be able to get that kind of a hold on the football.
Sideline pattern, Robinson. He's hit almost immediately after a pickup of three.
Well, Montreal sits in that zone. They're going to give you this pattern. It's only like a three-yard gain. And when he goes out in the flat, if that ball's thrown high like that, he's going to get another hit from Skipper like Pankratz got.
Second and seven for the British Columbia Lions. Roy DeWolf directing the attack. For some reason, some fans in British Columbia still have not really accepted Roy DeWolf. I fail to understand that one, as he has had some outstanding games. DeWolf's in a little trouble here. Gets away. Sidelines incomplete. DeWolf was under pressure that time, and that's something that the Montreal Concord felt they would have to do, is put some pressure on Roy DeWolf.
Well, they got it from their defensive ends, Rocky and Armstrong. They put the pressure on him, and if they're going to stop him, he wants the big play. They're a big play offense. They look for those long passes to Fernandes. You can't give him time to do that, and when you put the heat on him, he can't do it.
9 minutes and 22 seconds remaining in this opening quarter. 3-0 the score in favor of the Montreal Concord. Bailey and Young are back for this third down kick by Lou Pisaglia. Preston Young at the 32-yard line, and he is brought down there by three BC Lions. Kevin Konar was there, so was Rick Klassen. And that's where the Concord will scrimmage under the direction of Turner Gill. They lead the ball game by a score of 3-0. And the Montreal Concord, as there is a penalty flag on the play, attempt to break out of a tie for second place with the Ottawa Rough Riders. And the penalty flag appears to be a holding call against Montreal. That takes them back to the 15.
Well, as you were alluding to before, Ron, Joe Gallant said...
First down.
Joe Gallant said that he was going to run the football a lot against these BC Lions. Now, they ran it once and were stopped for no gain. They've got to stay in there and run it consistently and set a pattern. We'll see if they're going to do that or whether they go to the air immediately.
Dwayne Wilson, the second leading rusher in the CFL, inside. He picks up just a couple of yards and then is driven back by Ron Cherkis, so it will be a second and eight situation. Gill has hit on three of his first four pass attempts. I refer to the fact that Dwayne Wilson is second in CFL rushing, but he's a long way behind. As a matter of fact, almost 400 yards behind the leader, Willard Reeves of the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. Turner Gill in trouble. He loses the football. And the BC Lions have recovered.
That's just an outstanding play by Kevin Konar. That's an outstanding play by the linebacker, and he gets in there and causes them some trouble. He comes sneaking up there right at the end, and what a defensive play that he made.
So the BC Lions will have it first and goal from the five when we return.
In just 2 years since its introduction, this compact pickup has leapt ahead of all its competitors, overtaken the imports, overtaken the domestics. Ford Ranger, now number one in compact pickups. Number one in sales. In North America, Ranger outsells Chevy S10, Toyota, and Nissan. Number one in quality. Owner survey shows no one beats Ranger, import or domestic. And now Ranger is number one in price, lowest of any compact pickup. Ford Ranger, number one in quality, sales, and value. And built Ford tough.
Tomorrow in the CFL, the Toronto Argonauts are at home to the Saskatchewan Roughriders as the Argos attempt to rebound from their 34-33 loss a week ago to the Edmonton Eskimos.
So, Don, those kind of plays right here are what hurts Montreal. First, they had good field position on the punt return. They get called for holding. Then they don't gain anything on first down and then fumble the football. I mean, a four-yard drive, you can't give the BC Lions this many opportunities, especially when you're having problems. And Montreal will have problems against the Lions, so you can't help them.
The catch here, though, Ron, is that the BC Lions are too good a football team to be allowed the accommodation of getting the ball on the four-yard line. They were a little bit sleepy coming out here this afternoon, and Montreal just played right in their hands by fumbling the ball. This will arouse them, and nobody wants to arouse the BC Lions this early in the ball game, or it'll be a long afternoon for the Concord.
First and goal for the Lions with the fumble recovery by Mac Moore. The ball between the 4 and 5 yard lines. Roy DeWolf lofting it into the end zone. Touchdown as John Henry White grabs the throw on first and goal, and the BC Lions move in front of the Montreal Concord.
Play action pass, a great play on the first down there, Ron.
Well, that's an excellent call. John Henry White, you figure when they're on the 4-yard line, you're expecting the run on first down. Just a little bit of a play action fake to John Henry. Watch him go right
that's
by the linebacker.
That's an old off tackle fake, and then he just slides right out in the flat there, all by himself.
Pretty easy. Pretty easy. Too easy, in fact.
Point after by Lou Pisaglia. He puts it through. And the British Columbia Lions are in front of the Montreal Concord by a score of 7-3 with 8:06 the time remaining in this opening quarter.
You know, Don, a lot of the Western teams, when they come into the East with that 2-hour time change, it takes them a while to get adjusted. It's playing an afternoon football game, and they're a little bit sluggish first quarter. Don't give them a break in the first quarter. Get on them right away and try to get them down, make them come back. But this way, what's the replay? What's John Henry, number 20? Fakes the block, and you know right now, Harry Skipper knows as soon as he turned around, I made a mistake.
As soon as he turned around, said, uh-oh, don't throw the ball, please, and if you do, don't throw it straight because I'm beat.
He said, that's my man.
So with the John Henry White touchdown, the BC Lions are out in front. You talked about the difference in time. A 3-hour difference, actually, between Vancouver and Montreal. So, in effect, right at the moment, it's just coming up to 11 o'clock in the morning in Vancouver. So, there is some adjustment to make.
There sure is. And most Western teams are sluggish when they come in here in that first quarter. It takes them a while to get their bearings.
This is Vince Faison on the kickoff return, and Faison does a good job of getting it back out to the 38-yard line. He has done quite a job for the Montreal Concord in this capacity. He was not used as a kickoff return specialist with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. There, he was strictly a defensive back. But Joe Gallant obviously felt that Faison could do the job for him, and last year he sparkled as a kickoff return man.
He sure did, Don. You ought to point out to the fans why some of the BC Lions players aren't getting too close to their coach today.
Well, Don Matthews, the coach of the BC Lions, complaining about a bout of the flu, feeling just a little rough this morning. Turner Gill trying to run that football and gets it out to the 40-yard line, stopped there by Mac Moore and Ron Cherkis.
So this is the difference with a veteran quarterback and just a rookie quarterback. Gill went back there. The thing opened up on the pass rush. He didn't take it. He waited for a minute. And when he decided to run with the football, the rush lanes had closed down and there was no place to go.
Gill throwing deep, intended for Harold Bailey, incomplete. And it will be 3rd and 8.
Pretty good man coverage on the play, but he should have caught the football. He got up in the air and he was underneath the defensive back. He just didn't get high enough, went off his fingertips, and that would have been a big play for him. They've got to get the offense started, because the longer it goes, the stronger the BC line defense is going to be.
And they certainly cannot afford turnovers such as they just presented the Lions at their own 4-yard line.
And they better not give either one of these guys back here a little daylight either.
Darnell Clash with the ball. And Clash does a good job of bringing it back out to the 40-yard line after a 44-yard kick by Jerry McGrath, and he's brought down by Frank Cossack, a 14-yard return.
Well, the Montreal defense, the last game, played a pretty good football game against the Lions. They didn't exactly get run out of the park in that 22-7 score, but the whole thing comes down to the offense. But if they're going to hang in there, they've got to keep Fernandes under control, and it only takes one play for him to go the distance, so they've got to know where he is every time.
I get a kick out of watching that offensive line of the BC Lions come out of the huddle. They kind of walk up the line of scrimmage like old pros, but when that ball is snapped, something happens. They've got a good offensive line.
Penalty flag. Over the middle, complete to Tolu'umo. He fumbles the ball, and who has the football? Montreal has recovered, and there was a penalty flag on the play.
Well, they're going to get a breakdown. I believe it's against BC, so the fumble's going to stand. That's a big one for the Montreal offense if they can take advantage of it now. Just take a look. Watch, the ball's going to be tipped.
Preston BC Young, 25.
Looks like he got a hand on it and tipped it into him, and then he dropped it.
First down.
Well, for a pass receiver catching that ball downfield, when you catch it and you're looking downfield at the defenders, it's one thing. But when you make a spin and try to evade people, you've got to make sure that you hold onto that ball, because when you spin, you lose control of where the people are. And that guy just drove his helmet right into the ball, and the ball was gone.
First and 10 now for the Concord. Turner Gill with that rollout action, throwing over the middle. It's picked up. Mel Bird with the football, looking for some blocking help, and very quickly the BC Lions get the ball back inside the 45 of Montreal.
That was just a very poorly thrown football by Turner Gill. He gets outside with it, and they had a safety blitz on. If you watch, I don't know if you'll see Larry Crawford coming from the back, but that's a blitz. That's definitely man-to-man coverage, but it's just poorly thrown. There's nobody real close to it. Bird steps in, so the turnover goes the other way, and they gain field position.
He had awfully poor throwing action on that too, Ron, as he threw the ball. He wasn't set, and he was throwing off the wrong foot, and he made all the mistakes, and the end result was an interception.
Sideline pattern now to Tolo'umo, and he is bounced out of bounds. He will be very close to a first down. Ken Shanconi forced him out. Melvin Bird, who made that interception return, had a 115-yard interception return against the Ottawa Rough Riders back on August the 11th, the longest of the year in the CFL.
He sure did. He was in the clear at about the 20-yard line and just coasted down the sideline.
Well, it's nice to have a guy like Bird and Clash both back there, and Larry Crawford. They can all catch that thing intercepted and go the distance if you give them a little bit of distance.
Draw play with Tolo'umo, caught by Ken Shanconi after a pickup of two. On the previous pass, Tolo'umo had picked up the first down. And they rule this time that he is down at the 28-yard line. So it will be a pickup of four. Make it second and six.
What they want on this draw is to follow John Henry White, but he couldn't get in there, so he bounced it outside. Scott was waiting on him inside, so he tried to go outside, and Shanconi was out there waiting on him. It's like a lead draw where you follow the other back.
I thought it was a good play on DeWalt after throwing the ball to Tolo'umo and letting him fumble it to come right back to him. There's a touchdown.
They made it look easy. Into the end zone, Ned Armour grabbing the throw as he was in the clear, and Roy DeWalt laid it up there perfectly.
And DeWalt looks great, Don. And the point that I was making gives you the difference between a rookie and a veteran quarterback. He threw the ball to Tolo'umo down the field. He fumbled the football. He came right back the first down after the interception and did the same thing. Got the ball to him. He caught the ball. Now he's throwing the ball in there with a lot of poise. Touchdown.
Ball went in there like it had eyes. Jones just couldn't get there. Phil Jones, a safety. The ball's just out of his reach. The ball was perfectly thrown. Easy six.
So very quickly after putting the first points on the board, the Montreal Concord find themselves in a hole as the point after goes through the uprights from the toe of Lou Pisaglia. And with 4:33 remaining in the opening quarter, it's now 14-3. We'll be back with the BC kickoff right after this.
To my friends, a thank you song for being kind to me. To my friends, a thank you song for being kind to me.
This was for all of those who ever wonder if your United Way gift is really appreciated.
Friday night, the Ottawa Rough Riders entertain the Edmonton Eskimos. Next Saturday, Winnipeg is here at the Olympic Stadium. Saskatchewan visits BC. Sunday, Calgary is in Hamilton. The British Columbia Lions in front 14-3. Very quickly, they take advantage of turnovers. First, a fumble recovery and then an interception return. Two touchdowns, making it 14-3.
Well, watch DeWalt just throw the ball right in the hole. Just out of the outstretched hands of Jones. Nice, easy touchdown for Armour. You know, a lot of times you worry about Fernandes or somebody else so much that you neglect the other receivers, and Armour went right down the seam and got open.
Well, the British Columbia Lions have the talent to burn you with a number of people if you try and focus all of your attention on Swervin Mervin. Vince Faison on the kickoff return. Jamie Buis was the man who tripped him up at the 32-yard line. The fans reacting here at Olympic Stadium as Turner Gill continues at quarterback. They've jumped on him early in this ball game, somewhat unfairly, I think.
Well, that's a tough thing for a kid that comes out that's much sought after out of college. as we alluded to many times during the season, it takes 5 years to build a quarterback, and they're not going to do it overnight. And when they make all that money and they don't produce right away, the fans are tough on them.
Terry Lyman caught right at the line of scrimmage by Mac Moore.
You know, Don, we were talking to Coach Gallatin. He said he wanted to run the football against the Lions. Well, you've got to gain yards when you run the football. Now, that's about four times they've run. I think they've got a total of 2 yards.
You know, so the thing, though, Rod, about running the football against the Lions, the only way you're going to run it, I think, is on a sprint draw, because they're going to be playing Gill for a rollout or a sprint out one way or the other, and then he can hand off on that. But on a straight handoff, that BC defensive line is just too tough to run on. They don't give up the rush lanes.
Sure don't.
Gill passing complete for the first down on the far side of the field to Todd Brown, and he was driven back, but his forward progress had carried up to the 44. He was hit by Tyrone Cruz and Mel Bird.
The point that I was making there is the defensive line, they'll deliver a blow on a running play and hold their ground and play it about as well as you can. On a sprint pass or on a rollout pass, they'll start deviating their path and try to get to the quarterback to cut him off. That's when you can hand off to a fullback on a draw or something like this and get some opening on the rush lanes.
Turner Gill rolling out, running with the football. He finds a good opening. First down as he gets down to the 40-yard line. And that will take some of the fans who have been critical of him off his back.
Well, that's what Glatt said earlier. They was actually going to run a quarterback option. And this is Turner Gill's offense. Watch him, a little belly fake, and now it's him in the back. He cuts in, gets a lot of running room, and that's the only way you can sometimes get a quarterback to run with a football, call it a run, tell him there's no receivers, and there aren't any on that when they're down there blocking. That's a good job.
As Gallatin said, maybe I'll have to tell the receivers to fall down so that he'll be forced to run with the football. First and 10 from the 40-yard line. Rolling to his right this time, throwing deep into the end zone. Oh, he had the man wide open, and he overthrew Don Newman.
Well, Don Newman was definitely behind everybody. He had beat Darnell Clash to the post, and Nelson Martin was nowhere to be found, and he just couldn't get it to him.
There's also a penalty flag on the play. It appears to be a rough play call against the BC Lions.
Well, that'll make him feel a little bit better.
Unnecessary roughness. BC 28. First down.
Larry Crawford guilty of the rough play call. That makes it a first down at the 25-yard line. Warren Woods is the man in charge of the officials this afternoon, refereeing this ball game. We have 2 minutes and 8 seconds remaining in this opening quarter. It's a 14-3 game in favor of the BC Lions, but the Montreal Concord are threatening here.
Here comes the quarterback on that run right now with the option.
It looked as though he was going to pitch out to Dwayne Wilson, but he was hit by Glenn Jackson and James Parker.
Well, it doesn't take that BC Lions long to adjust. Here's the fake in here to the backfield with the option of the pitch coming out here, but you see it, you don't see it yet, but Crawford was right on the pitch, man. There was just nobody to pitch to, and he had to eat the ball.
Exactly right, the halfback, Larry Crawford, got into that backfield. If he pitches it, he'll make the tackle for loss. Force the quarterback to run, and then knock the heck out of the quarterback.
That was a quick adjustment, because I haven't seen Montreal run this offense, but they did it in a hurry.
Second and 10. Pass to Dwayne Wilson. He'll be about a yard, maybe 2 yards shy of the first down. Decision time now for Joe Gallatin. It will be third and 2. Dwayne Wilson indicates to the bench that they should be going for it. Kenny Ferdinand is going to come into the ball game, and Terry Lyman likely will come out.
Well, it's at this stage of the ball game, they've got plenty of time left to get back in the game. They've got 2.5 yards to go for a first down. Joe Gallatin definitely should kick the field goal. He's being dictated by the crowd, Ron.
Yeah, you
full house backfield with Harold Bailey coming out of the ball game with Denny Ferdinand in.
You got 2 yards to go. That's tough.
Turner Gill gets the first down as he scurries to the 10-yard line.
Well, he made it look easy. He made the fake and then followed the back. Cut well inside. That play is designed to go outside, but I'll tell you one thing. He took what he saw and cut right up inside. Watch the quick fake.
Well, he's done this so much in college where he looks to the inside and sees that opening and gets it. But it's still, regardless of the effects of the play, regardless of getting the first down, take the 3 points when you can get it, especially in the first quarter.
Well, that was a case of Denny Ferdinand throwing the block on James Parker that opened that hole for quarterback Turner Gill.
That's what did it. There's no doubt about that.
Turner Gill had some difficulty in the exchange from center, throwing into the end zone for Todd Brown, incomplete. There's also a penalty flag on the play. I'm certain it will be a procedure call against the Montreal Concord.
Oh, I think so. Everybody was gone but the center. That's he still had the ball in his hands.
Everybody wanted to be in the play, and the center said, "We haven't snapped the ball yet. You've got to come back here, but it's too late."
And that's the end of the first quarter. So the Montreal Concord will be looking at second and 10 when we return to Olympic Stadium in Montreal.
I work the CP railway line. I go where the steel rail guides me. I'm bound to haul a heavy
I work with are a pretty special bunch of guys. Loyalty is a big part of it. Railroad is on the whole, it's their life. Once it gets into your blood, it's pretty hard to shake it.
It's the people that make the railway. They're fantastic. You talk to anybody, especially the engineman and the trainman, they're very dedicated. It's just railway all the way.
I work the CP railway line.
If you want to get right down to it, it is a family, and we pull together. It's a team. Something this big has to be a team.
Wonderful life. It is full of excitement all the time. I would have done it all over again. I wouldn't take any pay.
A CP railway man is more than an operator of a railway. He's more than a businessman. He's part of the community, and he's proud of it.
Yeah, there seems to be that dialogue between the man on the ground and what management's doing. It's a people-oriented company.
CP Rail, helping Canada move forward.
Well, to use the old phrase, statistics are for losers. The Montreal Concord have the better stats, but the British Columbia Lions lead by 14-3. It's second and 10 from the 11-yard line. Turner Gill rolling out again. He'll run the ball. He may get into the end zone. He'll score.
They gave up contain completely on the outside. The linebacker dropped off, and the defensive end just didn't get there, and he just had a cakewalk right into the end
zone. Well, I tell you, he did another thing, too. He got outside the contain, and then he motioned deep. Watch him just wave his left hand as he gets outside to the left. Once he clears that last guy, he'll wave it, and then he just runs. He pumps that ball. They don't know whether he's going to throw it or not, and they can't come up as long as he's behind the line, and then he only had a 10-yard run.
And Ray Jones was forced to drop back with the receiver when he pumped deep, and he had that clear sailing into the end zone.
Made it look easy.
The point after by Don Sweet, and suddenly the Montreal Concord are back in the ball game. I thought for a moment when the BC Lions scored those two quick touchdowns that they might just turn this one into a rout. But now the Montreal Concord are trailing by just four.
Well, that's the guy that has to get it done for him. You see the good block. He gets outside of Parker, fakes it once, and then just jogs into the end zone.
Well, the one thing that the BC Lions have to do when they play against the Concord is to take care of the outside and make sure that the quarterback can't sprint out or roll out, and that's just the one thing that they're not doing. Because he's not going to drop back and kill you. He doesn't have the experience to read the defenses that well. They're not going to kill you with the running game on the inside. So the one thing they've got to stop is the outside rolls. Let that quarterback get outside of contain.
Don Matthews looking at this ball game as perhaps a stepping stone to first place in the Western Conference. It appears as though it will come down to a showdown with Winnipeg on the 27th of October, the final home game for the BC Lions. They would also like to maintain that one-game advantage over Winnipeg heading into that game. Darnell Clash from the 5-yard line on this kickoff return. And Clash is contained at the 25-yard line, driven back by Harry Skipper and Frank Kosek. The BC Lions, under Roy DeWalt's direction, have just two first downs, but they also have two touchdowns on the board. We're just underway in the second quarter. 14-10 is the score in favor of British Columbia.
Thank you.
Mervin Fernandez comes out wide to the right. He's being covered over there by Harry Skipper. They attempt to set up the screen. It's knocked down at the line of scrimmage. It was deflected at the line of scrimmage by Paul Martin. That's the second time that in dropping back the pass, with Walt in the first quarter and again here in the second, has had a pass knocked down by a hard-charging defensive lineman.
What they do is they bring him across the formation and they get a lot of heat, and then he runs out. There's a lot of room right here, but the ball gets knocked down by Martin. There's nowhere to throw it.
Back to the line, back to the front point. It makes the hit. The ball is fumbled and covered by the BC Lions.
Oh, boy, that was a real break for the BC Lions because Pointer was in there on top of the football and didn't stay on it. And the ball was kicked away from him, and the BC Lions got it back.
Al Wilson, the center, dropped back to recover. Watch the hit off Pointer from the blind side, and that pops the ball away from Roy to Walt. And it was almost picked up by Martin, but getting back, Al Wilson to cover up. A big break there for the BC Lions. On third down now, they are kicking from the goal area, but that could have been a Montreal first down just outside the 10. Preston Young takes the ball at the midfield stripe, and he fights his way out to the 53 of the BC Lions. And that's where the Montreal Concord will scrimmage first and 10 as we return to Olympic Stadium.
Sunday, September 23rd, 1984, the Terry Fox Run. The Terry Fox Run, Sunday, September 23rd. Run, walk, jog, sponsor, organize, volunteer to help, Sunday, September 23rd. Terry did his part. Now won't you do yours? Get involved. Sunday, September 23rd, 1984.
Winding up this weekend's activity in the Canadian Football League, tomorrow at CNE Stadium in Toronto, the Argonauts entertain the Saskatchewan Roughriders. And the Montreal Concord, trailing by just four, have it first and 10 at the 53 of the BC Lions. And Turner Gill, the young quarterback out of Nebraska, doing a good job on the last series, running with that football. And Ron, that's what Joe Gallant has been stressing to his young quarterbacks, Gill and Steve Smith, in the past couple of games, but they have not been executing.
Well, you know, you spend so much time on the passing game because it is important. They're young quarterbacks. They need to understand defenses. But a lot of times, then they forget that they can run with the football. And you know they did run with the football in college. There's no doubt about that. But they just get out of that habit of running, and sometimes you just got to call it to get them back into that habit. Tell them they have to run, period. Don't give them a choice.
That was Gallant's big concern, getting those quarterbacks running with the ball. He's got Dwayne Wilson running with it now. He won't go anywhere. He's thrown out of bounds by Larry Crawford.
That's that sweep off that bootleg series that they've had success with earlier in the season, but they didn't fool anybody from the BC Lions on that occasion.
Well, Kevin Conrad got over there along with Crawford, and the two of them were just waiting on him when he turned the corner.
On second and long, the BC Lions will go with six defensive backs as Ed Jones comes into the backfield. Over the middle, should be a first down depending on where they mark it. The catch made by Harold Bailey. Talk about young quarterbacks. Harold Bailey was a quarterback at the University of Oklahoma, drafted by the Houston Oilers. He played there as a receiver. Initially, he was sought by the BC Lions as a quarterback in 79-80. When Bobby Ackles, the general manager, was looking for a quarterback, he was negotiating with both Roy DeWalt and with Bailey. Oklahoma State product Bailey chose instead to go to the NFL, and Roy DeWalt wound up as the BC quarterback. A first and 10 situation from the 43. Benny Ferdinand picks up a couple of yards as he is in there in place of Terry Lyman.
Boy, they're tough from tackle to tackle.
That pass to Bailey, Turner Gill got it there, but if you think about it and seen how fast he delivered that football, he let it go in a hurry, because if he comes back to that, he better be careful. Kevin Konar got there just a step late. And you're throwing back against the flow, that linebacker will get underneath that hook, but he threw it so quick he couldn't get there that time. Just be careful with it.
Second and eight for the Montreal Concord from the 40-yard line. Gill's pass for Araki off his hands. And the big receiver had a very vital first down had he been able to squeeze that one. But you can't fault the quarterback on that throw. That ball was delivered well.
Well, my first reaction is off his gloves.
Off his gloves.
You know, get those gloves
correct.
Off and catch the football. Watch, the ball is there. And Araki's got both hands on it. And comes off of there. And it, as you say, it takes a big first down away from him.
You've never been convinced that those receivers should be wearing gloves, particularly at this time of year, have you?
No, I'm not even in the wintertime. I'm not convinced you need gloves.
Well, while you guys have been doing all that talking, I've been doing a little figuring here.
A 47-yard field goal attempt by Sweet is good. And that makes it a one-point ball game. 14-13, the BC Lions leading the Montreal Concord with 11:09 remaining in the half.
Our thinking here has changed from let's get a lot out to let's get the best out.
At Ford, we've made quality job one. We're producing the highest quality of all major North American manufacturers.
I've owned a lot of cars in my lifetime, but this Tempo has to have the best quality and workmanship of any car that I've ever seen.
Driving is believing.
Ford, I'm a believer.
Well, there are four games on the schedule next week. Edmonton at Ottawa, Winnipeg at Montreal, and we've got two on the CBC television network. Saskatchewan at British Columbia Saturday night, Sunday afternoon. Calgary visits Hamilton. The BC Lions have opted to have the Montreal Concord kick off after that successful Dawn Sweet field goal. The kicking game has posed something of a problem for the Montreal Concord all year. Jerry McGrath handles the kickoff chores. Dawn Sweet handles the placement assignments. And McGrath also looks after the punting game. This is one area that the Concord would like to improve.
Well, as I was saying quite some time back, while you guys were talking, I was doing some figuring, and the Montreal offensive line averages 268 points, or pounds, I should say, where the BC Lions are 267. And those are two big offensive lines.
Darnell Clash trying to get outside, and he is forced out of bounds at the 38-yard line. There's no doubt they both have some size up front along those offensive lines. You take a look at Miles Garrell, for example, of the Montreal Concord, 6'8", 300 pounds.
He's the biggest one of the bunch. But both lines are averaging right in there at 270 pounds. That's as big as you'll find them any place, and they can... Both lines can move. They both have great agility for big guys.
First and 10. The ball is placed at the 39-yard line. DeWalt complete to Tolaumu, and he struggles fighting his way out to the 47-yard line. He isn't going to take the easy route and go out of bounds. He struggled for the additional yardage trying to get that first down.
He likes contact. I just think back to that game when Montreal played him out in the dome at BC Place. He made a great run on a second down 10 situation on a little swing pass on the short side. He must have run over seven guys, gained 16 yards. He's not going to run out.
His big trouble might be that he'll hunt somebody up to run over rather than run around somebody. He likes that.
Second and two. And have they got it? It's going to be close. Tolaumu again carrying the ball. Now, normally he wears number 27. However, his jersey was stolen from the BC Lion dressing room, so as a result, he had to wear number 25 for this afternoon's game. It may be close enough for a measurement. Something unusual in that both these teams employ two import running backs. Most teams in the CFL go with an import and a Canadian running back. Juggling their import Canadian ratio and trying to move people around, but when you have some outstanding Canadian receivers, you can make some changes.
They put their number one quarterback sneaker in, the BC Lions. Tim Cowan at quarterback.
That's something Cowan does very well. On third and less than a yard, he drives straight ahead, and he has the first down. He had to get close to that 50-yard line, and I think they'll mark the ball close enough to give him the first down, although perhaps we've called this one somewhat prematurely, as they are calling for a measurement. And let's see where they do place this football.
Holy mackerel, he didn't get anywhere near it.
He may not have made it. The placement of the football is vital here, and I don't think, no, he did not make it. Well, initially it looked as though his forward progress had carried up close to the 50-yard line, but the Montreal Concours,
well,
as Al Wilson attempts to argue the point.
Watch Gray come in right there, the linebacker, and he really put a hit on Cowan and stopped that momentum right now, but, you know, just comes down to the referee spotting the football. They missed it by an inch. They didn't miss it by very much, but an inch or a yard, it doesn't matter. It's Montreal's ball.
Well, Paul Gray, Paul Martin, and Doug Scott in the middle block things up for the Montreal Concord, and they take over. On first down, Denny Ferdinand trying to hit off tackle. He has a couple of yards. It will be second and eight. It's 14-13. The BC Lions in front with 9:20 remaining in this first half.
You know, you were talking about the two import running backs. I know that Joe Gallant would like to have that number 34 Ferdinand in there more, but he has had that injury problem, and when he's 100%, he can do a great job for them.
Their average running from tackle to tackle is nil against this big BC Lion defense, so they ought to try on first down a play action pass and see if they can't loosen it up a little bit.
Turner Gill is in trouble. Big loss back to the 47-yard line. You can go to the well only so often against the BC Lions, and that time it was James Parker and Tyrone Cruz who brought him down.
Well, if you watch the top of the screen, this way. Now the linebackers just start to circle. They all blitz at him and force him up. He tries to run out. There's nowhere really to run because they get him pinned into the pocket. You see that linebacker going outside. Now he wants to get out of that pressure, but they're free back there. There's nowhere for him to run. Once that pocket starts to collapse, you're in trouble.
Now when you get it cut down from the outside and get the pressure coming up from the inside, there's no room in the end.
Mac Moore is the injured BC Lion. He appears to be in considerable pain as they check his right knee. Texas A&M product who signed with the Lions in 1981 has been a key man in that defensive unit that has been one of the most effective in the entire league. ...14-13 is the score. Statistically, as you take a look at the top passers in the CFL, Dieter Brock, in terms of yardage, leads the way. Tom Clements of Winnipeg is in third spot with Roy DeWalt second, but Clements has the best percentage, completing better than 65% of his passes. Dieter Brock of the Hamilton Tiger Cats has completed 58% of his passes, but Brock this year has had 18 passes picked off.
Turnover will get you. Fumbles, interceptions, and like losing the ball on downs is even a turnover. You don't want to do that too often.
Third down punt by McGrath. Now Bird runs it back out to the 27-yard line. A 46-yard kick by Jerry McGrath. So the BC Lions take over first and 10 with 8:28 remaining in this first half.
...814 million people in the world today cannot read or write. In developing countries, illiteracy can mean a life with little hope of advancement. A Canadian voluntary organization providing books and educational supplies to people in developing countries needs your donation. Give the priceless gift of reading and writing that will be passed down through generations. Send your donation today or write for more information to the Overseas Book Center, Development Through Education.
And from CFL Control in Toronto, coming up at halftime, Barb McLeod talks with Lions guard Glenn Leonard. All of the first half highlights, we'll see Calgary's come-from-behind win over the Ottawa Roughriders. Right now, back to Don Whitman in Montreal.
First and 10 for the BC Lions at the 27-yard line. They quickly jumped in front 14-3, but Montreal came back with a touchdown and a field goal.
Well, they're in the ball game. You know, they did come back. They got down 14-3, and you know, a lot of times when you're a young team or you've got the team like BC, they're the kind of team when they get you down, they kick you. But the Concords have come back, and they really have a pretty good control of this football game. They've got more control than BC does right now.
DeWald on first down, throwing to the sidelines. Pankratz, no catch. His foot had stepped across the line. There was no doubt about that, and the official on the sideline called it immediately.
That was a great call by the official, because when the ball was on its way, Pankratz did have his foot on the line, and the first thing that hit the ground was out of bounds.
It's second and 10 for the Lions. They are at their own 26-yard line. Now Montreal with six defensive backs as Preston Young comes into the ball game. Over the middle for Robinson, incomplete. He was cut down by Aaron Hill. Robinson, the ex-Montreal Concord, who indicated that he wanted to prove something against his former employees. And that time it was Aaron Hill who proved the point, coming in to cut down Robinson on the pass.
Well, what they're doing is they're so concerned with Fernandez outside, they're dropping Aaron Hill back to help out, and that opens the seam for Robinson. He should have caught that football. All Hill can do is come back to it after it's in the air.
Third and 10 as the Concord come up strong defensively, forcing the BC Lions into another kicking situation. 7:46 remaining in this first half. Good boot by Lou Pisaglia. It chases Preston Young back to the 30-yard line. He is downed at the 37. A run back of 7 yards after a 53-yard kick by Lou Pisaglia. The Montreal Concord coming into this ball game with a record of 3-6. The BC Lions, 8 wins and 1 loss. The best overall record in the entire Canadian Football League. Turner Gill, the rookie out of the University of Nebraska, continuing to direct the attack. Harold Bailey comes out, and Denny Ferdinand is in a full house backfield. Randy Fournier is playing that defensive tackle position in place of the injured Mac Moore for the BC Lions. There's the option, and the pitch to Dwayne Wilson, close to the first down, out to the 47-yard line. Well, so far, Turner Gill is following the game plan rather well. This is exactly what Joe Gallant wanted him to do.
Well, that play is very simply run, and what happens, watch Turner Gill make the quick fake to Ferdinand. He'll come outside, and the mistake there, you see number 10, Bird, came to the quarterback and allowed him to have the pitch man. We said a while ago, Leo, that Crawford came up and made the quarterback run. This time they didn't force the quarterback, they let him make the pitch.
Well, the whole idea of the option is to keep the man on the outside, take the pitch away, and then let the inside pursuit take care of the quarterback or the inside force. But Turner Gill has done that option about as well and as often as anybody has done it when he played at the University of Nebraska. And he knows how to do it. It should be a fine weapon in their arsenal, using him doing that option play.
It's just shy of the first down. The ball is at the 47-yard line. Dwayne Wilson on the bench as Ferdinand and Lyman move into the running back spots. Second and inches. Turner Gill keeps. He has the first down, driving straight ahead. He had to get up to the 49, and he reached that point on the field with 6:50 remaining in this first half.
You see the difference, Ron, and you above all can see it, between a quarterback that runs a lot in college and a quarterback that's strictly a drop-back passer. When it comes to running a quarterback sneak, they're so sophisticated. They know how to do it. They can get it easily, where a lot of times the quarterback that hasn't ran the football, he's so hesitant to run a quarterback sneak.
Well, that's why BC switches and puts Cowan in there, because he runs the ball a little bit better than DeWalt does.
First and 10 from the 49. Gill is hit just as he threw, and it is grabbed by Denny Ferdinand.
Oh, boy. That's the shortest completion in the history of the game.
James Parker, coming from the backside, hit the quarterback Turner Gill just as he threw.
And you'll see Gill come to his left, but you'll see number 40 coming, and he's going to hit him with that arm in the air and causes that ball to go up in the air. Took a good hit, but that's a good play by Ferdinand to get up and get that football, because there's a lot of white jerseys around there, too.
Well, James Parker is nicknamed Quick for obvious reasons. He can get into that backfield almost before the quarterback gets the ball. And James Parker has to be a candidate for our Carling O'Keefe Defensive Game Star Award on the basis of his play so far. Good hit by Cruz on Wilson as they tried to set up the screen, but Tyrone Cruz, the middle linebacker, read that one perfectly.
Well, Montreal tries to run that screen pass where they're going to let those defensive linemen come, and then they just swing the back. But watch the middle linebacker. He's watching that back, and then he just takes the shortest path, and that's a straight line. Watch him put the hit on the back. He doesn't mess around.
And watch him once he diagnoses that it's going to be a screen. Watch him go to it
right
now. You got to get there quick before the blocking can get in front of you, and he got there.
And now the third down punt return by Darnell Clash out to the 35-yard line, stopped there by Chuck McMahon. Third down kick by Jerry McGrath, fielded by Darnell Clash to provide the BC Lions with a first down at the 35. By McGrath. And a run back of 10 by number one, Darnell Clash. 5:20 is the time remaining. Chuck McMahon was the man downfield to make the tackle. DeWalt running away from the pressure, being chased by Steve Rocky. He has some room on the sidelines and wisely steps out of bounds. He appeared to stumble as he stepped out of bounds, and he is limping coming back. We talked with Roy DeWalt prior to the ball game, and Ron, you indicated to Roy that in some of the games we have seen this year, he did not appear to really push off as well as he should. He said he is still having problems with that ankle.
Well, where I noticed it with him is when he backs out of there to throw, backing up. He doesn't want to put a lot of weight on it, but he runs well with it. He had a lot of room when he came up the middle and showed good speed, but let's see what happens when he goes out of bounds. He tries to get that one more step, and then he stumbles a little bit.
Little swing pass to Tolu'umo. Oh, he broke a tackle, still on his feet, down the sidelines, and is finally stopped at the 27-yard line.
Well, you better tackle this guy, because he's not going to go down unless you get a good, solid crack on him and then get help from somebody else. He's indicated that all year long. When he catches that ball going down the sidelines, you'll see him right here. He steps out toward the sidelines and looks back in, and look at here. Two people missed tackles right there. He's still on his feet. Two more missed tackles right there. You know, this guy is a great 100%er with the football under his arm, and that's what Coach Matthews likes about him. He's never down until they stomp on him.
A gain of 23, he was finally corralled by Paul Gray. It will be first and 10 from the 27-yard line.
I'll tell you, there's some pretty good-looking tacklers over there that miss tackles. Skipper normally is a pretty good open-field tackler, and he just dropped him like he wasn't even in the ball game. Tolu'umo.
Paul Gray was injured on the play, so he moves out of that middle linebacking position, and Frank Cossack comes in.
Last year, Montreal had Willie Hampton and... what's the young man's name that goes to Winnipeg?
Delbert Fowler.
Delbert Fowler, and both of them are not there any longer, and they've got two new linebackers. That makes a difference in the defense.
They also had Kurt Garl, now with Ottawa. Over the middle, complete to Ned Armour. First down at the 10-yard line.
You know, you wonder when you look at the statistics. Montreal has 170 first downs. The BC Lions only 169, and you wonder how the Montreal team can't be making more yardage and how the BC Lions are making so much, as you see DeWalt back here and just put it in there. But they score and they move the ball so effortlessly, Ron.
Yeah, that was a good play by the receiver that time. Armour just finally found the open area for the quarterback.
For Fernandez, incomplete. Penalty flag on the play. They're ruling that Phil Jones, I'm sure, screened Fernandez. He had his back to the quarterback. As DeWalt lofted that deep into the end zone intended for Fernandez.
Well, the way this is interpreted, if he's got his back to the quarterback, no matter if he makes a clean swat on the
defensive
ball.
Defensive forward pass interference. Montreal number six. First down.
Even if he makes a clean swat on the ball, as long as he's got his back, and you'll see him right here, turn to the quarterback. See him? He may make a clean swat and not hit the receiver, but he's got his back to the ball, and it's called face guarding.
Jones protested, but to no avail to the official, and it's first and goal, BC, from the one-yard line. Roy DeWalt keeps, touchdown. No, he fumbled the football. The official there signaled touchdown.
Single touchdown.
The official on the sideline signaled touchdown.
Which absolutely means that if the ball crosses the plane, it's 6 points.
I'd like to see this again.
Yes, I would as well.
Well, let's see. We're going to get a good look at it. He's going in.
Yeah, he's got the ball over the white line, and then the ball comes out.
I didn't think so. He didn't go across the line with it. I thought that Montreal recovered. That's what I wanted to see, because Rocky got up with a football. Oh, BC's very fortunate to get it back.
They really were if he didn't have it going over.
Second and goal from the two. They did not make it. And it was John Pointer, the new addition.
I'll tell you who made a great play was Glenn Weir. Came from that defensive line position, and he got into that backfield and stopped it, and then Pointer was there to knock him down.
So now on third and goal from the two-yard line, Coach Don Matthews is sending in the field goal unit, and the veteran Glenn Weir, in his 13th season, has done his job, and he heads off to the bench. You're absolutely right. He was the man who stacked it up.
Well, that was a great play by Weir. He stripped everything, and that gave Pointer a free shot at the ball carrier.
From 9 yards out, a field goal attempt by Pisaglia. He puts it through. And with 2:13 remaining in the first half, it's now 17-13 in favor of the BC Lions.
The Provincial, Friday the 13th, bonus draw. All Provincial tickets bearing the July 13th draw date are eligible for the regular $500,000 main prizes and subsidiary prizes, plus 13 bonus prizes of $131,313.13 each to be drawn Friday, July 13th. I love Friday the 13th.
And you love Fridays in the weekly Provincial Lottery.
A new season of discovery. New specials with the world's greatest artists. New insights into the issues and events of our world. New programs to entertain you. New discoveries of every kind. Preview a great year ahead on CBC Television. Season of Discovery, September 24th. The best daytime drama, All My Children.
I'm so frightened.
And the original Dallas.
You're going to come out of this without anything. Huh?
All My Children, weekdays in Dallas starting October 1st.
Well, the Montreal Concorde came up with a big goal line stand, forcing the Lions to kick a field goal rather than get the touchdown it appeared certain they would pick up. Frank Kosak on the kickoff return to the 47-yard line. He was stopped by Randy Fournier. Fournier is playing that defensive tackle position in place of the injured Mac Moore.
Frank Kosak does a real good job on the special teams for Montreal. Young man from Toronto, went to school at Waterloo University, but always on hand. Good backup man in there for the linebackers and plays a tough game on the special teams.
Newman goes wide to the right. Todd Brown out to the left. First and 10, the ball at the 46. Trying to set up the screen, they do to Terry Lyman, but he gets just a couple of yards. And it was Rick Klassen and James Parker reacting to that one. And defensively, the BC Lions seem to be reacting extremely well to any attempts at screening or running inside by Montreal.
Well, Randy Fournier came through the way they want him to, allow him to rush. But Parker smelled a rat right away, and he turned around, and they don't call him quick for nothing. He came back and made the first play.
Second and 8. Gill will have to run with this one. He won't get the first down. He is stopped at the midfield stripe. But let's see where they place the ball. Ed Jones came in for the tackle.
He's going to be close enough to where they can go for it. He's going to be less than a yard.
I believe he may even have it on this one.
It looked as though he was downed at the midfield stripe, but they're ruling that he got to the 54 of the BC Lions. The measurement will determine whether or not he does have the first down. It's going to be very close. Just shy of a first down. It's about an inch short of a first down.
Give it to him.
Well, the Montreal Concorde are going to gamble.
Isn't that a gimme?
It will be if he gets over that next white stripe.
1:39, the time remaining in the half. Gill keeps, he's got the first down. The Montreal Concorde desperately want to come up with something before this half ends. They trail at the moment by 4, but it would certainly give them a boost to go to the dressing room with a field goal or a touchdown. Montreal, in terms of first downs, has the edge over the British Columbia Lions. But a couple of turnovers led to touchdowns for British Columbia. A fumble recovery and an interception, paving the way for major scores. Bailey, he has the ability to throw the ball. Oh, a bad throw. And it is fortunate for the BC line, or for the Montreal Concord, that BC did not pick it off. There's a penalty flag on the play as well. Rough play charged against the BC Lions.
Well, that was defensed about as well as you can. We'll hear what the roughing call is, but they run that reverse to Bailey, who has been a quarterback, and he was very, very fortunate that the ball was batted because his receiver was covered.
I think they call it on Crawford, but Crawford is...
Major foul, unnecessary roughness, BC 37.
Oh, they call it on Jackson.
Couldn't see what he did, but I know one thing, that he was, his receiver was well covered. Newman was downfield, he wasn't open. But that's a big one. They still got time to score, still got time to do something.
Well, we talked before about that guy being a quarterback, and they were going to use him to throw the ball.
Didn't throw that one very well. Gill rolling out. He had the option there. There's a penalty flag on the play again. He got back to the line of scrimmage, and that was about all, to the 38-yard line. Holding will be assessed against Montreal.
I believe it's Denny Ferdinand they're going to call.
Good penetration on the part of Tyrone Cruz, the middle linebacker.
Holding. Montreal 24. First down repeated.
Terry Lyman.
Lyman got the fours mixed up. 24, not 34.
Terry Lyman guilty of the holding violation. It's now second and 20. Back at the 48-yard line. With 106 remaining in the half. Pass is complete to Lyman, but quarterback Gill had to throw that one a lot sooner than he wanted to because of the blitz by safety Nelson Martin.
Well, that's what happened. Boy, Turner Gill took a pretty good hit that time. And the reason for it is very simple. They blitz one more man than they can handle, and number four came free on a safety blitz, and he puts a good hit on you at the best of times.
Going wide right as Newman, as Todd Brown comes out to the left.
They're a little bit out of field goal range. They've got to get something.
Gill throwing over the middle, incomplete. Well, there's the inexperienced quarterback in the final minute of this half. He used 20 seconds to get that play away. We were talking before the game, Ron, and I think when you were quarterbacking the Saskatchewan Roughriders, you used to be able to run 10 to 12 plays in the final minute of a half of the ball game.
Also adjudged that the reason he could do that was because he did it in Regina, where they gave him about a half hour every time he had the clock with 2 minutes left. I wonder you won so many football games out there. You had everybody on your corner.
We never lost because the clock ran out on us.
Penalty flag as there was movement at the line of scrimmage. The offside call against the BC Lions. And now, will the field goal unit come into the ball game? It will be a 48-yard try.
Offside, BC 63, third down repeated.
Randy Fournier, who is replacing Mac Moore at that defensive tackle spot, moved. And now the Concord field, they are within the field goal range of Don Sweet.
Well, he made a 47-yarder last time. This one's 48. This is about maximum distance for Don.
It's long enough. It's good. I said a few moments ago that the Montreal Concord desperately wanted to come out of this final drive with something, and they do. A field goal by Don Sweet, and that should give them a lift as they head to the dressing room with 33 seconds remaining. 17-16 the score. And again, early in this ball game, it looked as though the BC Lions might just run away with it as they led 14-3.
Well, their offense hasn't been consistent today. Outside of the last drive that DeWalt put together down the field, they had had their two touchdowns on turnovers, and they haven't established their offense against Montreal's defense yet. So this game still is hanging. Whoever takes control in the second half. Right now, Montreal's offense is playing as good, if not better, than BC's.
17-16 the score. Don Sweet has kicked three field goals, 35 yards, 47 yards, and 48 yards. That man, David Tolo'umo, has been the big man in the BC offense, both as a pass receiver and as a running back.
Actually, the big difference in the offense of the Montreal Concord this week is that little option play that they put in there that they've utilized so well with Turner Gill. It's made the big difference in their offense, and it's stretched the BC defense to the point that they're not as consistent with their rush as they normally are, and so it's given Turner Gill a little bit more time.
You're exactly right. The only time they've been in trouble is on second and long yardage. When they've been able to move the ball on first down, they've been okay. Good kick.
Good kick by McGrath as he found the hole, and it rolls back into the end zone. Darnell Clash starting out from about a yard deep. And Clash is brought down at the 14-yard line.
Well, you know, we've had two mistakes by the BC Lions. One on third down when they're punting the football. Don't be offside. Let them give you the ball. And this time, the ball got between their defenders. They're back to the 11-yard line. Those are two things coaches don't like to see happen at the best of times, but especially at the end of a half.
26 seconds remain in this first half.
Donnie Matthews is saying, just keep the ball on the ground, run out the clock, and let's go in and talk about this thing. Don't do anything crazy. Roy DeWalt's not about to either.
A handoff to Tolo'umo. Up to the 19-yard line with 22 seconds remaining. Stopped there by Doug Scott and Sandy Armstrong.
You got 22 seconds left. You got second down and 3 or 4 yards to go. Almost 5 yards, it looks like, for the first down. You play it safe.
Yep.
You run with the
game timeout. Montreal.
The Montreal Concord calling a timeout.
And this is the time when Donnie Matthews calls over DeWalt and he says, listen, there's only 22 seconds left on the clock. Run the ball on second down. Take as much time as you can. Punt the ball. And don't do anything foolish because we can't turn over the ball down here.
I disagree with you, Lou. You run the ball on second down. There'll be less than 20 seconds left. You'll stand in the huddle and wait till the clock runs out. Take the ball and fall down with it.
I mean, either
don't
way.
Punt it. Yeah, don't punt it.
Okay. You don't have to punt it then. The point is, though, don't make a mistake on second down. Do something
That's
foolish.
Right.
Willard Reeves, after that remarkable performance against the Ottawa Rough Riders, where he ran for 221 yards and earned selection as Rothman's Star of the Week in the CFL for the third time this season, by the way, leading the rushing derby 1,095 yards with Dwayne Wilson of Montreal in second spot. So perhaps Reeves' preseason prediction that he would run for 1,800 yards this season wasn't as far off as some of us suspected earlier in the year.
I know I didn't give him much chance at it, but with the number of games he has left, he has to at least have a shot.
On second down, and Tolo'umo continues to run hard. He is knocked down at the 20-yard line. The ball got away from him, but I believe the officials had ruled that he was down before it popped loose. But he runs hard.
Well, he sure does. He really runs hard.
He wears number 27 on his helmet. His jersey, number 27, was stolen, so he is wearing number 25.
Well, Don, Leo, looks like Matthews agrees with you. I just look up there and see 18 seconds, and I know I got 20 seconds to get the ball and play. I'm not kicking the football. But he's going to kick it. He'll kick it out of bounds, I'd imagine.
That's why he's in first place.
That's okay.
And the clock is running.
Now, if he gets this blocked, I'll never forgive him.
And they let it run right down. There'll be a time count violation.
Now they can quarterback sneak it.
Lou Pisaglia wanted to make sure he ran off those final 18 seconds on the clock. And now the offensive unit comes back in again.
Time count violation. DC number 5. Third down repeated.
Time has run out. This will be the final play of this first half. And Roy DeWalt, I'm sure, will simply drop to one knee. And the BC Lions will be heading to the dressing room, nursing a 1-point lead over the Montreal Concord. And That is the end of the first half. The BC Lions in front by a score of 17-16. Now, stay tuned for our halftime show.
This fall, programs that take you into new territory. Prisons. Parole and the struggle on the inside for a foothold in society. The lifer and the lady. Our most vital industry stands on shaky ground. The decline and fall of Canada's forests. And portraits of four courageous people coping with a crippling disease, arthritis. Laden with resources, Canada's high Arctic has always been a mystery. On rock, ice, and oil, some of the fascinating discoveries being made in this remarkable region. Money and the people that control it. A look inside a little-known world. The Brokers. Take a good look at your world on CBC Television.
David Suzuki takes you on a new season of discovery. The Nature of Things, this fall.
It is halftime. Welcome back, everyone, to CFL Control. A surprisingly close football game and an entertaining football game. The BC Lions leading Montreal by only 1 point, 17-16 at the half. We'll talk with Glenn Leonard. Barb McLeod will in just a minute. One of the first half highlights. Let's go back to last night. The Ottawa Roughriders, the Calgary Stampeders, McMahon Stadium in Calgary. We pick it up. There is less than 1 minute to play in the first half. Greg Vavra hands off to Lewis Walker from the University of Utah. It's an 87-yard touchdown for the game. Walker, 153 yards, giving him 565 for the season. That is third in the league behind Reeves and Dwayne Wilson. Calgary led 16-3 at the half. Fourth quarter, Watts is scrambling, finds Dave Newman, his first catch of the night. Ottawa, until then, unable to capitalize. In good field position, they trail by two. Hey, I mentioned scrambling. Here is a textbook example. Also, some sloppy tackling by the Stampeders. Watt should have been brought down, finds McKay. That set up a Dean Dorsey field goal. And with 35 seconds to play, Ottawa led 21-20. However, after some wild happenings, take a look at this. From 57 yards, no time remaining, J.T. Hay is good, 23-21. Calgary wins it, a 57-yarder. That is Hay's best ever. For your information, there have been two field goals in CFL history kicked from 59 yards, three kicked from 58 yards. J.T. Hay with a 57-yarder last night at McMahon Stadium in Calgary. Coming up, when we continue, Barb McLeod will talk with Lions guard Glenn Leonard. You're watching CFL 84 from our control center here in Toronto.
Dame Joan Sutherland sings Anna Bolena. With mezzo-soprano Judith Forst, the Canadian Opera Company, and bass James Morris as Henry VIII. Donizetti's opera of The Life of Anne Boleyn, starring Joan Sutherland. Anna Bolena, a CBC Television special presentation, Sunday, September 30th. The Emmys, a salute to the stars and the shows. Television's best, the 1984 Emmy Awards, this fall.
Sunday on CBC Television. Neighbors bringing you a load of laughs.
Morning, neighbors.
The people next door are kind of strange.
Gideon.
But it looks like they're here to stay. R.H. Thompson and Harvey Atkin are neighbors.
What do you want?
Living side by side in a comedy of urban survival.
I'm alive.
What are you doing?
The neighborhood will never be the same. Neighbors, Sunday night on CBC Television.
The United Way provides a helping hand to many youth agencies. I know. I've worked with the Boys and Girls Clubs for years. I know what these youth agencies do for so many young people, steering them away from crime, building character, developing social skills, and heading them towards a brighter future. The United Way youth agencies are in touch with the needs of today's young people. They are helping them to tackle their problems. It's just another way in which you can provide a helping hand by giving to the United Way.
BC guard Glenn Leonard is in his eighth year as a pro with the Lions. He has developed into one of the most consistent offensive linemen in the CFL. He weighs in at 265 pounds and admits it's hard to keep it that high. So, diet has become a very important part of Glenn's life.
We get just about everything from spinach pie to, whatever, turkey.
I always think of you as sort of a brontosaurus bone.
That's a stereotype football player. This big and he eats this much and he only does these things. And he's only capable of doing those things. There's a lot of people out there that believe that.
But that's what I want to hear you do is punch holes right in that.
Oh, certainly.
That's what you're doing right now.
Well, a lot of people think that. I love running into people that think that actually because. Most of the time, they have no idea, what athletes are all about. There's some very interesting people in professional football. I didn't know there was.
You've done a lot of things with young people. So we have one side of you on the field that's very intimidating, and then we have the other side of you that cares very much about what happens to young people and their future.
I've been lucky enough to be involved with a program that dealt with young juvenile offenders in a wilderness. Camp. Through it, I think I've learned more about myself than I have in football. Merely because you're put in situations where you have to look at yourself, whereas football, you're told what to do so much.
What actually did you do with them?
Well, I was given anywhere from 8 to 12 young adults. They're juveniles, actually, and. For 9 weekends, we would go through certain different parts of the program, starting with pretty scummy labor. Can I say that? Scummy labor. you do dishes, you clean the floor, you do calisthenics, you go swimming in the ocean in the morning, and you go running in the morning, and all sorts of things that young people nowadays don't seem to want to have anything to do with, but they're taught a little bit of
humility.
Yeah, humility and respect, I think, too. For each other. They learn to get along with each other. And of course, I teach them little courses, fire suppression, ropes and knots, first aid, things like that. Then they move along to climbing mountains, canoeing, building things around camp, things that are a little more important. And then in their final stage, they'd go off. I'd take them on a little expedition for a couple of days up in the mountains with very little. And then I'd put them on solo where they spend 3 days out in the mountains with nothing but. A little shelter, a sleeping bag, the clothes on their back, and an insulate, which is a little foam pad. And during this time, they get a lot of time to think about what they've done, and what they've learned, and what they're going to do when they leave camp. And this period of time, I think 90% of these kids learned something that was very, very valuable to them. I mean, a lot try to sleep the night away, but it just doesn't work that way. And then they graduate the following weekend. And when those kids graduate, I've never seen one that didn't smile.
That's very heartwarming. It's kind of like a forced meditation, isn't it?
Oh, the solo part of it is, yes, yeah, certainly. But the neat thing about that program, although those kids might learn something every weekend, every time I came home, I did too, which is great. I mean, you can't ask for much more.
What did you find out about yourself?
Well, I've changed an awful lot. I like the new me more than I like the old me.
Well, tell me more about the new you.
Well, I think I just understand myself a lot better. Understand why I do certain things, why now I don't do certain things. And you just have a better feeling about yourself. I'm certainly not wonderful, but to me, I'm happy with what I've learned.
That is interesting. Glenn Leonard, the guard who once played for the University of Manitoba Bisons.
You know everything, Brian. I thought you might like to know, though. Glenn is recently married, so you can imagine just how much his wife is involved in all this diet business. She is winning. He has had an order of merit made for her, and it's hanging proudly in the kitchen. No junk food for him, Brian.
I feel sorry for him. Listen, you've just come back from a Western swing. You've talked with some very interesting people. Who are we going to be hearing from in the weeks to come?
It was a good trip. I'm really passionate Canadian now, Brian. You're going to be meeting the Eskimo general manager, Norm Kimball.
Right.
You'll be meeting Winnipeg head coach, Cal Murphy. Players, I better check here, Daryl Moyer, Greg Vavra, James West, Brian Kelly. I mean, the list is
long.
Good trip. I'm glad you guys did some work out there for a change.
Oh, we work hard.
Stay with us. Our halftime show continues. We will take a look at highlights from the first half of this football game. Surprisingly good game. The Lions lead the Concord by a single point. Stay with us.
An exclusive offer from CBC Enterprises. Pope John Paul's visit to Canada. A special 90-minute commemorative video cassette highlighting the papal tour. This cassette is available for a limited time only for only $34.95 plus $2.75 postage and handling. To reserve your copy on Beta or VHS, call toll-free 1-800-361-0170. Visa and MasterCard accepted.
His mind was at the computer. His body was missing. They had 48 hours.
Please begin tracking.
He's in there.
Found him?
He'll turn up eventually.
Terminate him now.
No!
His only chance for survival, to hide in a computerized fantasy.
You are losing him!
Overdrawn at the Memory Bank, a movie special, Saturday, September 22nd.
The Journal. Weeknights following the National.
It is halftime. Welcome back to our control studio. The British Columbia Lions in a surprisingly close football game, leading by 1 point. Don Sweet's field goal gave Montreal a 3-0 lead in the first quarter after a fumble by Turner Gill. BC with a ball on the Montreal 4-yard line. Roy DeWalt hits John Henry White with a play-action pass. 7-3 Lions. Another turnover. Turner Gill intercepted by Bird. That set up Roy DeWalt to Ned Armour. It's a perfectly thrown football, 14-3 BC in the first quarter. First play of the second quarter, though, look at this. Turner Gill is trying to pass, runs it in from the 11. Montreal trailed 14-10. Don Sweet has kicked 2 field goals. The Lions have 1, and as I say, in a surprisingly close football game, it is British Columbia leading Montreal by 1 point at the half. It looked like BC was going to run away with it when they got the 14-3 lead, but the Concord have come back and come back strong. Right now, Don Whitman, Ron Lancaster, and Leo Cahill standing by at the Olympic Stadium.
Well, it's a 1 point game. The British Columbia Lions leading the Montreal Concord, and something of a surprise. And if the Montreal Concord should win the ball game, it would certainly be the upset of the year in the CFL.
What do you think, Ron?
Well, I think the BC Lions are back to where they have been for the past 4 or 5 weeks. Offense very sporadic, you know, just not being able to consistently move the football. Montreal's defense played well against them in BC. They're playing well again today. The big key, as we talked about earlier, the two young quarterbacks of the Concord turned it over twice early, but it didn't get them down. They have come back, and now they are, I think they are in better chance to control the game, Leo. Would you agree?
I think so, and I think the big thing was that option play that they put in there to change up the offense for the Concord a little bit. Here we're going to see that quarterback sneak that was questionable. The official on this side raised his hands and indicated touchdown. But somehow they feel that the ball was kicked loose and they weren't awarded a touchdown and consequently kicked the field goal.
Was he in? What do you think?
It looked as though he may have been across that goal line, but obviously not. In the view of the officials, the ball popped away and the BC Lions recovered, but they were forced to settle for a field goal rather than a touchdown. Right now, let's return to CFL control and Brian Williams.
All right, thank you, Don Whitman. Tomorrow afternoon, there is one game in the CFL. The Saskatchewan Rough Riders play in Toronto with Calgary winning. The Riders have to win. They trail the Stampeders by 5. The Argonauts in first place by 8 points. Stay with us. Lots more to come. The second half kickoff is up next as we return from Montreal's Olympic Stadium.
This fall is dramatically different on CBC television.
People have started talking.
The forbidden love of two people. The rulers and the ruled. The last days of an empire. The jewel in the crown.
What you're gonna do? You're gonna go away and be a soldier.
The wars. Conflict between a mother's love and a son's duty.
Are you gonna win?
Bit.
Backstretch. A fight to the finish on and off the track.
There's more than pleasure in marriage. There's lots of worry and pain, too.
One family struggle for a better life. The Tin Flute.
How do you want me to help?
A British subject and you're not Jewish.
The true story of a hero who helped others escape from Nazi-occupied Europe. Charlie Grant's War. great drama. Good evenings on CBC Television.
Well, I'm sure that at halftime, Coach Joe Gallat told Nebraska rookie Turner Gill that he must continue doing the same thing over the final 30 minutes, and that is to run with the football. Use the option play. He has to move the ball. He can't afford to be dropping back to throw the football. He has to be rolling out and throwing it.
Well, the thing is, Don, the last time we saw the Montreal play was in Hamilton, and he did not look very good at all. He looks a lot more relaxed today, and I think that's because he is running with the football. He's more at ease at the way he's played before in his career, and he feels more at ease running, Lil.
You know, he's trying to do the same things that he did against Hamilton, but I again point to the fact that that option play that he's running has loosened up that BC defense to the extent that they're not penetrating like the Hamilton defense did to take away that sprint out stuff and roll out stuff that he's doing. One time they just dropped off the line of scrimmage and gave ground, and he ran it in for a touchdown.
Well, before the BC Lions get this kickoff underway, we should point out that Miss Montreal Concord for 1984 was named at halftime, and the lovely lady is Teresa Girois, who will represent the team in the Miss Grey Cup contest in 1984 in Edmonton. Terry Lyman on the kickoff return, putting his head down and driving to the 35-yard line. So that's where the Concord will scrimmage first and 10 to start this second half. Bernie Gleer and Nelson Martin were both in on the stop. Statistically, in that first half, in terms of net offense, the BC Lions had the advantage, but the Montreal Concord had five more first downs. And Mac Moore, who was injured in that first half, has returned to that defensive tackle spot. The ball is fumbled on the exchange with quarterback Turner Gill. It popped away from Dwayne Wilson, but I believe Nick Araki got there to scoop it up on behalf of the Montreal Concord. A very lucky break there for Montreal. They turned it into an 8-yard gain.
Yeah, watch it. It's a bad handoff. He never does have control of it. It's gone already, and they are very, very fortunate to get it back. Parker just misses it, and Araki gets that big frame of his in there and blocks out 5 yards, and he gets it.
Nelson Martin, I think, was waiting for Parker to pick the ball up, and as a result didn't jump on it, and Nick Araki went in and split both up and got the ball.
On second and two, looking for the first down, and Terry Lyman is out across the 45-yard line. He was brought down by Tyrone Cruz and Andre Jones, but not before he got the first down.
Well, that's played about as well as you can play it from a linebacker position. They got the blocks made, and all he has to do is run through there, but that middle linebacker, Cruz, got to the hole at the same time, and that's all you can ask. You're not going to stop him for no gain.
First and 10 from just outside the 45. Play just underway here in the second half. Montreal trailing by a single point. Pass drilled over the middle to Nick Araki. He'll be close to another first down at the midfield stripe.
Defensed as well as you can. Konar was right there. Number 31 is right on top of Araki, but the ball is right there, and Nick gets those big hands on him, and it's in there. Going to get a good look at it when it comes back. Watch from the quarterback's position. Watch him drill it in there, but watch the throw.
He got it to his body position. He just had his body turned between he and the defender, and there's no way that unless you go through him that you can get to the ball.
Turner Gill on second and inches. He keeps for the first down.
The history of this BC Lion team, though, has been give you the 5 yard, give you the 10 yard, give you the 15 yard, and then take it away from you. And conceptually, you got to say that Donnie Matthews, being a defensive specialist, has done a tremendous job with this team. They've had all kind of injuries throughout the years that he's been the head coach the last couple of years, but they've always come up with a team concept on defense that's been very, very good.
Newman goes out wide to the right. Todd Brown comes out to the left. A handoff straight ahead to Terry Lyman. He picked up just a couple of yards. Lyman is back in the lineup of the Montreal Concord after missing 4 games because of injury. Glenn Jackson was there on the stop.
Glenn Jackson having another good game. He's been our Carling O'Keefe defensive player of the game throughout the years on a couple occasions, and he's playing another strong game today.
Well, he goes out of the ball game on second and 9, and coming in is Ed Jones. 6 defensive backs now in there for the BC Lions as they anticipate a passing play. There is the pass, And it's complete to Harold Bailey, and he continues on for the first down. You know, looked as though he was going to be stopped. I think the defensive back almost eased up.
I think he thought he dropped the ball. He just pushed him.
You know what I believe? I didn't think Larry Crawford even thought they'd throw the ball to him. He figured he had him covered. But take a look at it. He's trying to get off. Now he makes the break to the outside, and Crawford figures he's not going to throw the ball out there. He didn't really even try to tackle.
I think he thought he was falling down when he caught it. And he just caught his balance and recovered and made enough yardage for the first down.
And that's really all that matters.
That's right. Get him home before it's all over with.
There's the handoff to Dwayne Wilson. Wilson breaking through for a gain of 9. Jones and Nelson Martin stopped Dwayne Wilson very close to another Montreal first down.
Well, that's that misdirection play where they start in one direction and then just hand back. It's almost like a draw. And they pull the lineman out, and he, for the first time all afternoon, has found a vacancy between tackle and tackle and just got through there. And if they can open up that middle, that could be the secret to winning this football game.
Well, the coaching staff attempted to send in the short yardage offense, but it was waved off by Turner Gill. He gets the lineman first down.
They took too long getting that short yardage team in there. If you're going to send them in there, get them in there. Otherwise, the quarterback takes one look, they're not coming, he calls the play. And he called a pretty good one.
He gave the ball to Terry Lyman, and there's an injured BC Lion on the play.
And if that's Crawford, they could be in real trouble.
It is Larry Crawford who is down. He last year was chosen the outstanding defensive player in the CFL for the Rothman Star of the Week selections. But it appeared as though he perhaps was just winded or shaken up a little, but I would think from the way he's walking off that he'll be able to return. So now Ed Jones is into the ball game in his place. First and 10, the ball is at the 27-yard line. Hand off to Dwayne Wilson, and Wilson has another first down.
Well, Coach Gillette was saying before the ball game, if they could start one way and get Tyrone Cruz going that way and then wall him off and cut behind him, they'd be able to run inside, and that's what they've done so far two times in this quarter for the first time in the ball game.
Well, this would almost indicate to you that they found something at halftime that they could talk about, because they were unproductive during that first half, trying to run from tackle to tackle. Now they've found it two or three times in the second half.
They go inside again with Dwayne Wilson, and he fights his way to the 12. Pickup of 2. It will be 2nd and 8.
Well, that first down would be a great place in that position on the field, just like DeWalt did earlier in the ball game, to come up with that play action pass off of that run that they've been successful with and just throw it in there for a touchdown. But second down now, and it's a predictable passing down.
Larry Crawford is back in there.
Gonna have to roll one way or the other.
Gill passing for a first down to Dwayne Wilson as he gets inside the 10. Nelson Martin forced Wilson out of bounds, but it will be first and goal, although perhaps prematurely we have called the first down for the Concord as they are asking for a measurement.
Well, you see Wilson go in motion, and then he just swings straight out of there, and that forces Nelson Martin to come a long way to cover him. Ball's well thrown, a good position, got his body between it, and he's right down close.
It's a first down, Montreal. First and goal, Montreal, from the 4-yard line. This has been a good drive that the Concord have put together.
A good spot right here for that quarterback draw, right?
Well,
take a couple steps backwards and step right up inside if you can get those linebackers out of there.
Yeah, I don't know if you can get them out of here down there. BC likes to play man-to-man and blitz you down here. Let's see what they do. If they don't blitz you, you got a shot at it.
First and goal, the rollout action. He has some interference out there, but penetration was made by Kevin Konar to break it up, and then Tyrone Cruz came over to help out.
Well, he lost.
Had about 5 red jerseys out in front of him, though.
He sure did. He had a convoy done, and he lost patience and turned it up inside. If he stayed on the outside of that convoy, I think he would have walked in the end zone.
You know, Kevin Konar's played a fine game today. He made the first fumble. He caused the first fumble to set up a touchdown, and he's made a couple big plays for him throughout the afternoon.
Second and goal from the 4-yard line. Gill rolling to his left this time. He's got the same situation, trying to go outside, and he is stopped at the 2-yard line. That time, had he cut in, I think he might have made it. On the previous play, he had to go wide.
That was run all the way. There wasn't any doubt about it. His receiver, number 16, is down the field already throwing blocks for him. Don Newman's in the end zone blocking, so he wasn't looking for the ball.
Well, Joe Gallant obviously is going with it. But take a look. I think if he had cut inside, he might have made it.
What do you think?
I don't think that he saw, he didn't see that one blocker pick up that linebacker.
Coming inside.
Had he saw that blocker pick up that linebacker, was wide open on the inside. Now, I don't know about this call right here.
He's going to run again.
Third down and 2 yards to go.
They're gambling on third down, rolling to his right.
He has
now run Tyrone Cruz. There's the pass. Touchdown! Nick Araki.
That was not a pass. That was a designed run. Nick Araki saw he wasn't going to make it. Turner Gill knew he wasn't going to make it. And Araki went to an open spot, and Gill found him.
Well, that was shades of the same type of a play that Nebraska failed on last year to win the national championship against the University of Miami. Although it was a power pass to the outside or an action pass to the outside last year. This year, he rolled to his right. The guy that was in the flat, instead of turning out to the flat, you'll see it right here. He rolls to his right, and Nick Araki checks off and comes back in the middle. He throws against the grain, right back in there to Araki, and Araki was wide open.
And the point after by Don Sweet, and the Montreal Concord have the lead with 7 minutes and 16 seconds remaining in the third quarter. And we'll be back with the Montreal kickoff after this.
The Pope in Canada. Follow the tour with CBC Radio or see it all on CBC Television.
Music, art, and dance are alive this fall on CBC Television. Oscar Peterson, Michelle Legrand, and Claude Bolling in a once-in-a-lifetime concert called Grand Piano.
Exploring the field is part of both my art and my nature.
An exploration of the art of Robert Bateman and the work of one of the 20th century's greatest sculptors, Henry Moore's A Family of Man, The Artistry of a Genius. And the group of sevens, A.J. Casson, shares his secrets.
I think what makes a good artist is to be an individual.
And a tribute to a legend, ballerina Anna Pavlova. Take a good look at the arts on CBC Television.
Well, Nick Araki, number 79, certainly was in the right position at the right time, accepting that throw for his fifth touchdown of the year. A big touchdown for Montreal as it puts them in the lead for the first time since early in the ball game. And again, McGrath attempting to aim that kickoff. This time it's fielded on a hop by Darnell Clash, and he gets it back to the 37-yard line. You may recall, just before the end of the first half, he was able to find the hole between those two kickoff return specialists. But this time, Clash fielded it on the hop and brought it back to the 36, a run back of 20 yards.
You know, Don, the Concord used up over half the third quarter on that one drive, 13 plays. And I'll tell you, when you run 13 plays and still score, you've done something.
Well, the BC Lions have only had 6 first downs in the ball game. They'll get another here with Robinson out to the 48-yard line.
And especially when you're a rookie quarterback, Ron, if you can handle that ball 13 times on a sustained drive for 75 yards without making a mistake, you're arriving.
Actually, he made a mistake on the very first play of that drive where the ball was fumbled by Dwayne Wilson. Right. And fortunately for the Concord, Araki was able to scoop it up.
Well, they gave DeWalt an awful lot of time on that particular play and allowed Robinson to go down there and find a hole.
Back to the live action. There's the pass on the sidelines. And a man running with that ball. And it's picked up in midair by Vince Faison. Faison still going all the way back to the 25-yard line. Well, there was a case of second effort going against David Tolomo, as in struggling for additional yardage, he had the ball popped away into the hands of Vince Faison, and the Concord will take over first and 10 at the 26 of BC.
Father Lucien Lar,
The Order of Canada is given to Canadians by their fellow Canadians as a tribute to personal achievement. Father Larry's love of humanity led him to found the Bosco Home in Regina for adolescents suffering from drug abuse and emotional problems. Stricken by polio at an early age, Father Larry taught himself to walk and went on to complete extensive university studies. Father Larry's Bosco Home has succeeded beyond measure in restoring troubled young people to their rightful place in society. The Order of Canada, something for all Canadians to be proud of.
In just 2 years since its introduction, this compact pickup has leapt ahead of all its competitors, overtaken the imports, overtaken the domestics. Ford Ranger, now number one in compact pickups. Number one in sales. In North America, Ranger outsells Chevy S10, Toyota, and Nissan. Number one in quality. Owner survey shows no one beats Ranger, import or domestic. And now Ranger is number one in price, lowest of any compact pickup. Ford Ranger, number one in quality, sales, and value. And built Ford tough.
Well, we'll see DeWalt roll to his left. Tolalumo or whatever he is, he goes out, catches it. Makes a good move right here. Now, this is when you said second effort goes against you. The ball just pops up in the air and right into Faison's hand. Well, that's a great break for the Concorde because they're in good field position with a six-point lead and a chance to add to it. And, you know, you let that young guy Gill get started, he can be awful tough.
Boy, Faison, for a defensive back that hadn't been a punt returner or anything, knows what to do with that ball.
Handoff inside, and there is no running room as Ron Cherkis stood his ground at the defensive tackle spot. Vince Faison having some equipment adjusted at that Montreal Concorde bench. Both he and John Pointer previously played with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, attempted to make it in the National Football League, both with the Green Bay Packers. And interestingly enough, both came back to the CFL in the employ of the Montreal Concorde.
I bet he rolls to the wide side of the field, Ron. Good job there.
He's in trouble, but he heads for the sidelines and steps out of bounds at the 24. So it will be a third and eight situation, and the field goal unit comes into the game. Don Sweet will be trying for the fourth time to split the uprights this afternoon.
Well, I'm surprised at that because on a sure passing situation where you have to make up a lot of yardage, he's probably mostly ineffective on a straight drop back pass because that BC team can come on their rush. Those big guys can get their hands up in the air. He's not a great drop back passer and he hasn't got a chance to run. He tried to run at the last minute, but it was just too late from that drop back. Whereas on the rollout, he's got that option of running or throwing.
John Swede has hit from 48, 47, and 35 yards, and he puts it through from 31. So now the Montreal Concorde lead the BC Lions 26-17. And we have 5:07 remaining in this third quarter.
Well, they're going to force the BC Lions to open it up. The BC Lions have been very conservative. I don't think Mervin Fernandes has caught a pass yet. They're going to have to open this thing up offensively because the defense of the Concorde is dictating to BC right now. They're not allowing them anything.
Well, Coach Gallant had indicated that the defensive alignment they would try and use on Fernandes was to roll up on him with that defensive back.
When they say roll up, they want to put that cornerback, either Francis or Skipper, right up on top of him. Then drop the inside halfback like Aaron Hill deep so that if he gets by him, you got help. And then they want to hit him hard coming off the line. And that's what they've done. They've kept him under control so far. And that, I'll tell you what, when you do that to the Lions, it throws their whole offense off.
Well, you really don't get the illusion, though, that the Montreal team are stopping everything BC is doing. BC is kind of stopping themselves and getting down there and not scoring. And well, you're just waiting for a team like BC to break it wide open because they're playing against young quarterbacks and they're just a seasoned veteran team that's the leading team in the country in terms of games won. So you just think that they're about ready to do anything any moment.
Darnell Flash fields it at the 22-yard line. Looking for some blocking help. And he runs it back to the 43. Next Saturday, live from Toronto on CBC Sports Weekend, you'll see the Seagram Cup Stakes. That's live on Sports Weekend next Saturday. First and 10. Roy DeWalt throwing it over the middle to John Henry White. Stopped a yard short of the first down by middle linebacker Paul Gray.
Now, Ron, you were pointing out before that we haven't seen too much to Fernandes. That's understandable. They've got double covering him, but he'll still get loose somewhere along the line. But we haven't seen much of John Henry White either. And both of these guys have been great contributors to the overall success of that football team.
Yeah, all we saw John Henry do really was catch that touchdown pass from the 4-yard line on the play action fake. Outside of that, he hasn't touched the ball too much.
How about a play action pass here on second and one?
Not a bad idea. Going to go one-on-one with Murray.
Penalty flag on the play. Pass incomplete. It was Andre Francis defending against Mervin Fernandes. There was also a penalty flag on the play. Andre Francis, in his second year in the CFL, has developed into one of the better cornerbacks in the league.
Boy, sure has. We've done three or four of the games this year. He's played well in every one of them, and he's the kind of guy that's going to get better all the time. He's not very big. That's what surprised me. He doesn't have the tall, rangy size that a lot of them like say, Ray Odoms in Calgary. He's kind of a short guy, but I'll tell you, he gets up there and gets the job done.
The penalty against the BC Lions, and penalties have certainly hurt the Lions this afternoon. Let's listen to referee Lauren Woods.
Holding. DC number 20. First down repeated.
There's something John Henry White did this afternoon.
He won't be too proud of that one.
So now it's second and 11. Armour is wide left. Fernandes could be the first receiver in the CFL this year to go over 1,000 yards, but so far this afternoon he's not had a chance. And Roy DeWald is buried back at the 36-yard line. That stop was the first man through.
Boy, they did that with a four-man rush, Leo. They really put the pressure on him inside. Armstrong and Doug Scott both coming in there did a good job of containing.
At the last minute there, DeWalt was going to throw the ball, and the only guy out there to throw to was Leonhard. And Leonhard gave me rub off. He said, I don't want that ball. So he pulled it down and took the licking.
Oh, you see him going back in the pocket. Watch how fast he collapses around him. Forced him to step up, and bang. Down you go.
See Leonhard standing out there.
Offensively, the BC Lions haven't really put it all together this afternoon. Preston Young on this third down punt return, a good boot by Lou Pasaglia, 45 yards, and Young runs it back to the 37-yard line. And the Montreal Concorde, after that 6-yard return, will be first and 10 when we come back to Olympic Stadium.
Now you can find out everything about lotteries where you see this Lottery Ticket Center sign. These locations, specially selected because of their knowledgeable and trained staff, have all the winning numbers, even if your ticket is 1 year old, and will cash small and medium prizes on all the games they sell. So visit your nearest Lottery Ticket Center, pick up a copy of Luck Magazine, and read about lottery winners and what's coming on your favorite games. Lottery Ticket Centers, your sales and information centers.
Six years ago, Shenley Award winner Jim Coode was 260 pounds of solid muscle. Today, at 92 pounds, he is dying from one of muscular dystrophy's 40 diseases. MD is incurable and can be fatal. MD can strike at any age. But most of its victims are kids who won't get a shot at fame like Jim did. These kids deserve a chance to grow. Give them that chance. Please give and let live.
.322 is the time remaining in the third quarter. It's first and 10. The Montreal Concorde at their own 35-yard line, and they lead by 26-17. Early in the ball game, the 15,000 plus fans at Olympic Stadium were booing the young quarterback Turner Gill, but they have been cheering the young man from Nebraska over the past 35 minutes or so of this ball game. Terry Lyman, the ball carrier, he was stopped by Ron Cherkis. And when you start running the ball well and throwing it effectively, that quickly turns the boos into cheers.
The last time they booed him, he ran the next play for about 25 yards, and he hasn't been booed since.
Second and 5. Gill will run the ball. He'll get the first down. Diving across the 50 to the 51-yard line.
There's that middle opening up. He starts back and looks like he's going to roll to his right. And when he does this, it changes the rush routes. He starts back and looks to his right, and then he comes right back up the middle, right back to his left there. And there's nothing over there over the right offensive or the left offensive guard. There's a hole wide open. He makes his first down. Now he's got three things he can do now. He can run the option, or he can run that inside game effectively, or he can roll out.
He gives it to Dwayne Wilson, who picked up just 1 yard. It will be second and 9.
Joe Gallant from the sidelines must be saying, the last time we had the ball, we kept it 13 minutes, and they're not going to beat us as long as we can keep it away from them.
I don't think they kept it 13, Leo. 7 minutes and 40-some seconds. They
13 plays.
13 plays.
That's right, Doc.
Statistic, 18 first downs to 7 first downs for the BC Lions, and that tells something of a story. Second and 9. Straight drop back, Araki the receiver. Touchdown. Andre Jones and Larry Crawford collided, knocking each other away from the receiver. Nick Araki, and he's got his second touchdown of the afternoon.
Everything's happened to the BC Lions. One thing about Araki, if you're chasing him from the back, Ron, he's too strong to knock down from the back. You got to get on his back, and if you do, he'll ride you in the end zone.
Well, I was watching the other side of the field, and I was watching Bailey, the slot back, and he dropped back in there to block right away. So you know they're going to try to go deep, and it just happened to be Araki. And once he gets rolling, he's got a lot of speed, and he's really good. They really have the pressure on the Lions now.
Point after by Don Sweet. He puts it through. 1 minute and 20 seconds remaining in this third quarter, and it's 33-17.
You're going to see it right here.
You'll see number, I don't know if you see number 20, but he's blocking. There's nobody in the middle. Andre Jones couldn't knock it down. Larry Crawford can't bring him down.
Andre Jones got the hand in front and tried to, and actually he came in behind, and when he did, he cut off Crawford, and Crawford couldn't catch him in the pursuit to run him down for the goal line. See, jumps in front of him right there, and he cuts off Crawford, who's in full flight. Crawford would have caught him if he hadn't been cut off.
They shouldn't try to tackle him high, though, as big as he is. He'll carry him 5 or 10 yards.
That's right.
Oh, we're going to see him again. Watch him cut across the middle.
Now watch Andre
come in. What a big target, huh?
Inside him. Now cut off Crawford. And there's no way Crawford can get to him, so he's got to reach, like you say, and grab him by the jersey. And Araki just is like a runaway freight train. He's not going to be denied.
There's an injured Montreal player, Rob Smith, right guard, was shaken up on that point after. But Nick Araki certainly merits some consideration for our Carling O'Keefe offensive game star with his performance today. He recovered that fumble on the drive to start the third quarter that eventually led to a touchdown throw from Gill to Araki. Then he comes up with another touchdown on the throw from Turner Gill, as Rob Smith is still down and being treated by the Montreal training staff.
Well, there's one guy, Don, that you mentioned on both occasions when you were talking about Araki that has to get some consideration too, and that's Turner Gill.
The man who got him the football, indeed. While we have a moment, let's mention for the benefit of our BC viewers a couple of football games in the BC Junior Football Conference next Saturday, a doubleheader at Empire Stadium in Vancouver. In the opening game at 5:30, the Renfrew Trojans will take on the Richmond Raiders, while at 8 o'clock, the Vancouver Marilomas tangle with the Okanagan Sun. The Okanagan Sun play out of Kelowna, and Kelowna this year will be the site of the Canadian Junior Football League Championship. They've got quite a week planned for Kelowna. They're calling it Sunfair 84. And, of course, it will culminate in the Canadian Junior Football Championship game. Nick Araki with 6 touchdowns now on the season. Not a bad average, 14.6 yards per catch.
That's a great average for a tight end, and that's about what he is. When he gets in the middle, he's a great target to throw to.
Should mention that Canadian Junior Championship game in Kelowna on the 10th of November.
Nick Araki is what you might refer to as an endangered species. Not very many tight ends left.
Flash on the return, gets it out to the 24-yard line, a run back of 14 yards after a 55-yard kick by Jerry McGrath.
And this program is copyrighted and is strictly for the private use of our audience. Any reproduction, retransmission, or exhibition in whole or in part without the express written consent of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation is strictly prohibited.
First and 10 from the 24. We're moving into the final minute in this third quarter. DeWalt flipping it over the middle to John Henry White, and he gets to the 45.
Well, we talked about White before. There's just so often that you can deny he or Merv Fernandez, and if they're going to win this ball game, White and Fernandez are going to have something to do with it.
What the BC Lions are just not getting anything deep. With Robinson going deep, all these guys, then the back swings out, and John Henry just comes right underneath the linebacker, and he's wide open coming through there. Him open. There's nothing to it when he gets that open, but the Concord are going to be sitting deep right now, not allowing any big long plays. That's the thing that can hurt him right now.
Procedure called against the British Columbia Lions. And we have mentioned a couple of times how penalties have hurt this team today, and this 5-yard assessment will make it a first and 15 play now from the 39.
Procedure, BC 21, first down repeated.
Pancras.
70 yards assessed so far against BC via the flag. First and 15, they swing it out to Tolu'umu. He continues to break tackles and strive for additional yardage, and he gets back to the 47.
The BC Lions,
finally by Doug Scott.
They come back with exactly the same play. This time they're going to take and again check John Henry White under here and then swing Tolu'umu out here, and instead of throwing to him, they throw to him. Then he can block for him. He doesn't get a block for him. Watch.
He tries to get a block.
John Henry White come underneath.
I saw him go out there and try to get a block, but the defender outran him.
That's right. Now he should be out there blocking for him. He's kind of looking around.
Well, he made an effort to get there, Ron, because I watched him when he wasn't the pass receiver, and he made an effort to get there, but the defender just beat him to the spot.
Ned Armour on the receiving end of the throw, hauled down, but he has a first down at midfield, caught there by Vince Faison. And that's the final play of the third quarter. The Montreal Concord lead it by 16, and the BC Lions will have a first down when we return.
Halfway through the party, everyone ran out of things to say. Then at the stroke of midnight, someone appeared with the Sperry PC. It looked like most other personal computers, but it had a more comfortable keyboard, dramatic color graphics, IBM software compatibility, and it ran 50% faster than the IBM PC. Now everyone had something to talk about again. The Sperry PC, what the personal computer should have been in the first place.
This arc we call planet Earth is in serious trouble. We lose one wildlife species every single day. By the end of the 80s, it could be one an hour. In Canada, 15 wildlife species are on the brink of extinction, and the list is growing. Contribute to the World Wildlife Fund today. We'll see that every single cent saves wildlife.
Well, for a long time this afternoon, while the Montreal Concord had the edge in first downs, the BC Lions had more yards in total offense, but that has changed. Montreal now has 259 yards, and that's 40 more than British Columbia, and they also lead by 16 points. And again, we point out how penalties have definitely hurt the BC Lions this afternoon. Head coach Joe Gallat. He has to be pleased with the way his team has performed so far, particularly the young quarterback. Mervin Fernandez caught by Harry Skipper. A fine defensive play by the Montreal cornerback.
Well, that's a great defensive play. That's just like a little quick screen to the flanker. They send a back across in motion to help out, and then they hit Fernandez. He tries to run, but boy, did Skipper come up there in a hurry.
Don Matthews has to be concerned about the lack of offense of his team this afternoon.
Only
but Harry Skipper
downs.
Came up with a key play there as he grab Mervin Fernandez, and now Roy DeWald is trapped and brought down by Armstrong, who followed up after the initial pressure by Steve Rocky.
Well, you know, you keep thinking that the BC Lions are going to come alive and cause something to happen, but not this time. He had nowhere to throw it. He gets chased out of the pocket by Rocky, and now you see the big tackle, as you say, underneath, and now they've got to punt it. Armstrong got that hand around that ankle and brought him down. So now they've got to give it up again, and the Concord, as you saw in those stats, have really taken over the second half. They've owned it.
Well, there was a stretch of games where the BC Lions had problems scoring touchdowns. It appeared as though they may have corrected those problems last week with their 46-11 win over the Hamilton Tiger Cats, but they appear to be in existence again this afternoon. A penalty flag, and I'm sure that blocking from the rear will be the call against the Montreal Concord on that attempted punt return. That was a good kick of 51 yards by Lou Pisaglia.
Ron Robinson blocked from the rear. There wasn't much doubt about it. It happened right in front of the official.
Well, that could be the edge right here that the BC Lions need, because they're going to put the Concord in real bad field position right here, and if they can hold, get the ball in good field position, they'll be back in there.
Let's see if it is him.
Illegal block. Montreal 16. First down.
Don Newman guilty of the illegal block.
I knew who I meant, 16. I knew who it was.
Number 16, but the wrong team.
Well, you'll see just to the left of your screen right there, he's getting pushed in the back by number 16, which is Newman. And the referee's standing just out of the picture there, and he was right on it.
First and 10, back at the 6-yard line. Terry Lyman finds a bit of a hole and runs it out to the 14.
Boy, you know, he came very close to breaking that into the open field, and it looked like he was going to be stopped for no gain.
One of the great things you always wanted to do when you're playing is keep that offense on the field as long as possible, and the Montreal offense has been on the field most of the second half. As you say, Leo, he almost broke it. If he'd have got by Andre Jones right there, he has a clear shot to the goal line.
This is a big play for the BC Lions.
Roll out action by Turner Gill. He'll run the ball, and he'll be close to the first down.
Again, Don, that was run all the way. Newman was downfield blocking on Darnell Clash, clearing that out, so he had no pass receivers. That was a design play, and he was going to run with it.
Now what do you do?
You just kick, get back there and punt the football.
He's going to be maybe a half a football short or so. I think they'll get it.
You think they should go for it down here?
I think they will if it's that close.
I don't think Joe Gallant is going to have that much nerve.
I think you got to go there. Got to go get it. Half a football.
Well, they send in that short yardage offense. Coming into the ball game, Rocky McMahon and Denny Ferdinand. They have about half the length of the football.
Montreal
pick up a first down.
The Montreal club's so high right now, I don't think anybody can stop them.
This could be the ball game or a key play in determining the outcome right here. Turner Gill should have it. Let's see where they mark it. He hit it off to the left side, and he followed the two big guys over on the left side, Lloyd Fairbanks and Miles Garrell. Fairbanks, 6'4", 240. Miles Garrell, 6'8", 300 pounds.
Yeah, they can clear a path for you. You only needed a half a step.
It's not a good call.
Great call.
Yeah. That's how coaches go into the insurance business.
Now, in terms of first down,
hard to broadcast it.
A big edge for the Montreal Concord. Dwayne Wilson stopped after a pickup of perhaps 1 yard. Turner Gill has been utilizing his two running backs, Lyman and Wilson, almost equally this afternoon.
Well, they got the second and long yardage now, Leo. This is where he should roll to the wide side of the field. Let's see.
But importantly, in that third down gamble, something else I think we should point out is that they used up some time on the clock by retaining possession of the football.
And what we haven't seen yet is that delayed drag to Iraq.
I'll tell you, if they don't make that first down, they use up some numbers on the scoreboard.
Is it picked off? No. No, Konar in front of Nick Araki looking for the interception.
That's good defense by Konar. He really thought he caught the football. The main thing is they're going to get it back, but if they're going to get back in the ballgame, they got to score quick now. Time is definitely against them.
Block, block, guys, block. 16, the time remaining.
They not only have to score, but it looks like they're going to have to go for two. If they do score, they need 16 points to get back in the ballgame.
They need a big return or else a block punt, one or the other. They got to get some life. They've had no life the second half.
Darnell Clash retreats to his own 45-yard line. Clash trying to get outside. Nick Araki trying to contain him and finally makes the tackle. Araki did a fine job of fighting off the block out there to contain Darnell Clash and bring him down. 33-17 with 10:57 remaining.
Look at what Canada is selling to pay for our houses, our cars, our televisions. We're selling things like potash and coal and lumber. And CP Rail is playing a major part in moving these goods to market.
I work the CP Railway line.
The railway has a very strong impact on everything, everyday life. It doesn't matter what you look at. The railway handles it all.
CP Rail.
CP Rail, helping Canada move forward.
Well, we'll be doing some traveling next weekend. On Saturday night, we'll be at BC Place as the Lions entertain the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, and Sunday afternoon in Hamilton as the Ticats play the Stampeders. The BC Lions returning home immediately after today's game. Prepare for next Saturday's date with the Saskatchewan Rough Riders. Of course, Saskatchewan in action tomorrow afternoon against the Toronto Argonauts.
That's great stats, 15 for 21, but it hasn't been very productive for him.
I'm surprised that they don't roll one way and get Fernandes the other way and try to get him on a one-on-one, because any time that they roll toward Fernandes, they're always going to get help from that safety.
And you can see the help's already there on this play.
DeWald is being chased and caught by Doug Scott.
Well, I tell you, it's just amazing. You know, the Montreal defense, the second half has owned them, and the same thing with the offense. They're only rushing four guys, and they're putting all kind of heat on DeWald.
But even the easy scores that the BC Lions had early in the ballgame, I had the impression when they came out here this afternoon that they were dozing a little bit, and they really haven't caught fire. Even after getting that second touchdown so cheaply, they just haven't caught fire, as you see. Scott come in there on a great defensive play and get DeWald on the ground for a big loss.
Saw him split two linemen, too, doing it.
He went through Roper and Al Wilson. There's the pass complete to Ron Robinson for a big first down for the BC Lions.
I don't know why he jumped.
Didn't have to. Could have caught it on the run.
Caught it on the run and split those defenders, and he might have gone a long ways.
Watch him. He's going to go right in the seam to your right. He could get right in the hole between the linebackers and secondary. He makes a catch. He didn't have to jump. You're exactly right. Catch that ball and keep running.
Back to the live action, throwing deep. It's picked off as Harry Skipper comes up with the ball.
He's going to go a distance, too.
He is stopped at the 38-yard line. And there's also a penalty flag on the play as we have a skirmish back in the vicinity of the 19-yard line. Now we've got a number of players involved. You don't like to see this sort of thing happen. This was well behind the play following the interception by Harry Skipper. But that ball by DeWald was well over the intended receiver.
Ronnie Robinson was going down the seam, the same pattern, and he tried to go deep with it. And Robinson either got knocked down or tripped, but he went onto the ground, and then it was overthrown.
We have 9 minutes and 33 seconds remaining in the ball game.
Let's hope there's no ejections.
Did you know that there are four ways to play Lotto 649 and Lotto West? In person, you pick your own favorite numbers. By subscription, the numbers you choose are automatically played for 13 weeks or more. Combination play, an easy way to play different predictions on one ticket.
I'll have a 649 and a Lotto West Quick Pick, please.
And Quick Pick, where the machine randomly picks numbers for you. Whichever way you play, you'll find them only at your lottery ticket center.
Well, the unnecessary roughness call against Andre Francis of the Montreal Concorde brings the ball back inside the 25-yard line after the interception by Harry Skipper. And you see that we have 9:33 remaining in this ball game. The Montreal Concorde looking for their fourth win of the season. And at the moment, they are in control.
Well, you see Harry Skipper running with that interception. And you can see just in the middle of the screen, Francis and Pankratz were got a hold of one another, and Francis gets called for the roughing. Those kind of things will happen, but not very wise.
It's a bad time to have it happen, though, because they lose some real good field position when they're in a commanding position on the field. Asked Joe Gallant before the game, the coach of the Concorde, whether his team could win today, and he said, yeah, I think we can. I thought he was kidding, but it looks like they may be able to.
Well, for those who watched our telecast out of Hamilton a couple of weeks ago when the Concorde lost to the Ticats, you would certainly have to doubt whether or not Montreal would be able to take on the number one team in the country, but they have certainly turned it around. What a difference. And I suppose that goes with a young, inexperienced football team. Hot one day, cold the next.
Well, we saw them against the Eskimos right here in Olympic Stadium. They look great. Next week against Hamilton, they look as bad as you could look, and then today they're coming on again. So you're exactly right. They're young, and when you get those quarterbacks playing well, those young ones, that's what the difference is with them.
Second and eight for the Montreal Concorde.
Careful.
Complete to Nick Araki. He got away from Nelson Martin, but is going to be stopped short of the first down by Larry Crawford.
Good defensive play by Crawford, because he only needs one step and fall forward, and Crawford cut the legs out from under him.
Well, to show you what defense has done for the BC Lions throughout the year, I think I mentioned this before. Here, we're going to watch Turner Gill, first of all, get this ball out to Araki. And Araki changes directions and gets back a little bit, maybe gives up a first down here. But Montreal, 3,092 yards, as opposed to the BC Lions, 3,115. That's very close. You'd think that the BC Lions would have a big edge in total yardage going into this game.
Third down kick. Taken by Mel Bird and brought down at the 46-yard line. That was a 42-yard kick by Jerry McGrath with 8:19 remaining in the game.
You know that Montreal has been a rushing football team a lot this year, one of the leading rushing teams in the league, but it's surprising when you see that those young quarterbacks have only been sacked, or their team has only been sacked 22 times, as opposed to the BC Lions being sacked 39 times going into this ball game.
First and 10 from the 46. DeWalt to Ned Armour, hit immediately by Harry Skipper. Let's give him some consideration for that Carling O'Keefe Defensive Game Star Award.
Boy, he's having a great game. University of South Carolina Gamecock.
Every time they've thrown the ball in his direction, even if it's been completed, he has put a hit on him. He hit Pankratz early. He put Fernandez on his back. Now watch him again. Bang, hits Ned Armour. He's arriving the same time the ball. The two corners for the Concorde have just done an outstanding job today.
Boy, he hit that Pankratz early in the ball game.
Second and three. Roy DeWalt is caught and tripped up by Paul Martin.
Well, I'll guarantee you this. That was a missed handoff, because DeWalt's not going to run the football, especially with still suffering a little bit from that ankle. He just misses his handoff, and as a result, he's going to be forced to give up the ball. I really believe I might have to think about going after it.
I'm just wondering.
There's the play. There it is.
When you're thinking about going after something, he missed John Henry White. John Henry White's in there blocking. Doesn't look like he knew he was going to get the ball at all. Must have been Tolomo that was supposed to get the ball. But what would you think about going to Tim Cullen as your quarterback, Ron?
I'd have to do something. With 7 minutes left, number one, I wouldn't be kicking the football right now. Down 16 points.
And they aren't going to kick it. The direct snap. John Henry White will not make it. This Montreal team has played superb defensive football this afternoon. 6:58 is the time remaining, and the Concorde will take over in BC territory.
Ducks around the globe. In Canada, the United States, and Mexico. In Canada, Ducks Unlimited is busy building marshlands for ducks to come home to. Because every year, ducks instinctively fly south. Why? Why not? Ducks Unlimited works internationally to provide good homes for ducks everywhere. Ducks Unlimited. Two ducks in every home. No, two homes for every duck.
Conserving wetlands for wildlife.
Well, this is what's happening next week in the Canadian Football League. Games in Ottawa, Montreal, Vancouver, and Hamilton. And on CBC television, you'll see Saskatchewan at BC Saturday night, Calgary at Hamilton on Sunday. And it's 33-17 here at Olympic Stadium in Montreal with 6 minutes and 58 seconds remaining. Well, as far as GameStar selections are concerned, there are a number of candidates on the roster of the Montreal Concorde. There are a number of BC players who could earn that distinction as well, but the Montreal Concorde are leading by 33-17, and they have had some great individual performances. As we see, the Montreal cheerleading contingent, certainly with something to react to this afternoon. This is Dwayne Wilson. Fine run inside the 40-yard line, first down. For a moment, I thought we were seeing a preview there of the Michael Jackson concert that takes place here at Olympic Stadium on Sunday and Monday.
There's a flag down out there, Don. I don't know whether it's thrown by mistake or dropped by the official. No, they're bringing it back.
That will wipe out a good run by Dwayne Wilson.
Well, when you're hot, you're hot. Montreal are getting hot.
Holding. Montreal 79. First down repeated.
You see a good block. Miles Gurrell just flattens James Parker right there to get Wilson outside with the football, but Araki got caught for holding, and they bring it back, and that hurts him. But that was a great block.
Bud Gurrell, he can block out the sun as big as he is.
First and 20. Pass is incomplete. Off the fingertips of Wayne Wilson, and it almost deflected into the hands of Nelson Martin.
It's a well-thrown football by Turner Gill. He had Bailey just cruising across the middle, and he just couldn't hold on to it.
The rookie out of Nebraska, an All-American shortstop, drafted by the Chicago White Sox. Tremendous athletic ability.
Well, I think if you're talking about the BC Lions, if you see the end of this play, he should have caught it right in his hands. Dropped it, and plays like that can break down the consistency of a drive. And if BC gets the ball, they still have plenty of time.
Second and 20. Over the middle, complete. Wayne Wilson again, but he is about 8 yards short of the first down, in the grasp of Ed Jones.
Came right back with exactly the same play, but a different receiver. He brought Wilson out of there and circled him back across the middle, and he was wide open.
Now we're talking about the BC Lions. They're a big play team, and when they're not making big plays, they've got to depend on their defense to win for them. And as an indication of that, Montreal with 170 first downs going into this ballgame had more first downs than BC had. BC had 169.
That's perhaps the best kick of the day by Jerry McGrath. There are penalty flags on the play. They were on the turf before the ball was even kicked.
There's got to be too many men on the field. That's what they throw when they're back there. That referee or whoever it is back there, that's what his job is. Well, that's another mistake by the Lions.
Referee Lauren Woods moves back to the line of scrimmage.
Very alert by the officials picking that up.
I believe that's going to get him 10 yards and a first down.
That will be a Montreal first down with the ball at the 43-yard line. And again, we reiterate an earlier statement of how costly penalties have been this afternoon to the Lions.
Too many men. BC. First down.
Well, we've said this a lot of times during the season, but if you're a team like the BC Lions that have won so many games and have played so well, you can't afford to lose a football game to a team that you should beat. And that's what they're doing out here this afternoon. They should beat the Concorde.
First and 10 from the 42-yard line, and Dwayne Wilson is tripped up. A loss on the play of a couple of yards as the penetration was made by Tyrone Cruz, the middle linebacker. He's had a strong game.
Well, that was an excellent play by Cruz because Miles Gurrell was leading the ball carrier, but Cruz just got underneath him. you watch the ball, a quarterback will spin. The tackle will come this way, but he's going to get a great play by this linebacker, and he gets underneath the Gorrell, and Gorrell's so big he can't get down there to hit him. But watch him coming through the hole, right underneath him, makes the tackle. That's what that middle linebacker is supposed to do, and Cruz is a good one.
Draw play, fumbled by Wilson, recovered by the BC Lions. Kevin Konar has the ball, pitches it out, and Darnell Class is brought down at the 44-yard line. I don't know about the wisdom of that on the part of Kevin Konar. There are penalty flags as well, as he pitched it out just as he was being tackled.
Yeah, he pitched it to Martin. Parker made the tackle on the draw. He is quick.
I think you're going to see that Parker was called for a late hit on one of the Montreal players here, which would have been another dumb play.
Roughing against the BC Lions. So although the BC Lions get the football, they will be moved back towards their goal area to start this series.
There goes Parker.
Major foul, unnecessary roughness, BC number 40, first down.
Well, that's amazing because he made the tackle and then got up. Watch the draw right here. Now watch number 40 come in and make the hit. Now the ball's fumbled. Parker jumps up and gets into the action and gets called for roughing. He's hustling, but a little bit.
You know what he did, though? He grabbed a hold of the ball carrier and didn't let him get to the fumble, and the ball carrier kicked at him, and then Parker got up and pushed the ball carrier, and Parker got the penalty.
Over the middle to John Henry White, close to a first down, hit by John Pointer. We have 4:09 remaining in the game, 33-17. The Montreal Concorde lead the BC Lions, and there's an injured Montreal Concorde. Andre Francis, way downfield.
Cramp.
Appears to have a cramp, as DeWalt is going to take advantage of this injury timeout to go over and talk to his head coach, Don Matthews. The measurement reveals a BC first down.
Well, when you're a back like John Henry White, and you know late in the game, yeah, you can see the way they're pushing up on the toe. It's probably a cramp. They'll get that out of there in a minute. But
good,
you know,
diagnosis,
you know they're going to drop back.
Lancaster.
Those linebackers are going to be back there at least 10 yards. And when you throw the ball that far downfield, they're going to take a hit when they catch it. And they sure did. Let's see if we can see where that cramp hits him. You see
right
him hopping
there
around right now. It already hit. I think everybody has suffered from those at some time or another.
So Andre Francis heads to the bench. And that means that Bill Jones and Preston Young will be in there defensively now. And there have been a number of potential game stars for our Carling O'Keefe offensive and defensive game star awards. Making the choice in this one will be somewhat difficult. Roy DeWalt throws it off to David Toloyumu, and he is out of bounds at the 53.
Well, they're going to be very content to give up those 10-yarders right now. There's no way they can win the football game with a 10-yarder.
Uh-oh, there goes the flag up in the air again. Something happened on the sideline. Somebody said something to an official or something because the flag went up in the air.
3:46 is the time remaining. Is the penalty against the Montreal Concorde? I believe it is. Objectionable conduct.
Well, there's been a lot of those calls this year, objectionable conducts.
You witnessed a game over in Saskatchewan at Taylor Field last Sunday involving the Rough Riders and Calgary Stampeders.
Objectionable
there were
conduct.
A number of those calls.
Montreal 65, first down.
I'll tell you, the BC Lions could be fined for objectionable conduct on a lot of plays today. Not necessarily for roughness or anything, but just because they're not playing as well as they can play.
Pass incomplete. It was intended for Ned Armour. Aaron Hill was defending against him. It will be second and 10 from the 46.
Just delivered that ball awful high, and Armour might be tall, but he wasn't that tall. Aaron Hill's out on the corner now in place of Francis, so they thought they'd try to go at him, and it didn't work there either.
Second and 10. Hernandez wide to the right. Hernandez the receiver, and he gets to the 26-yard line. A first down there, tackled by Preston Young.
You see, you notice though, Ron, the BC team are just kind of lackadaisically getting back in the huddle now and looking like they're 20 points ahead instead of 16 behind.
They just clear Robinson down the seam and turn Fernandes on a little in pattern to the inside, makes a catch. But you're exactly right in what you say. They should be hustling around right now. They're losing.
That's right. DeWalt should be getting them in the huddle and really moving them.
3:03 is the time remaining in the ball game.
Thinking here has changed from let's get a lot out to let's get the best out.
At Ford, we've made quality job one. We're producing the highest quality of all major North American manufacturers.
I've owned a lot of cars in my lifetime, but this Tempo has to have the best quality and workmanship of any car that I've ever seen.
Driving is believing.
Better and better, see what we've done at Ford. Quality is job one.
Ford, I'm a believer.
Watch those linebackers drop. You see Fernandes make the catch. Paul Gray's going back in there, gets one hand on him, but misses him. Fernandes is tough when he gets hold of it, but a little bit too late for the BC Lions today.
See, they should be out on the ball. Fernandes, of course, is so dangerous when he catches that football. Among the receivers in the CFL, I think he's as good as anybody in running with the ball after he catches it.
He may be the best, but that's the first pattern he's caught downfield today. The other one was a little quick screen.
First down from the 26-yard line. Pass complete for Fernandes. First down as he dives across the 15 to the 14-yard line with 2:51 remaining in the game.
You want to talk about throwing it on the break. Fernandes' back was still turned to him when the ball was let loose, but he just turned in there and picked it off. They've run that pattern a couple times.
First and 10 now from the 13. Over the middle, incomplete. Robinson went up for that ball. I think it was intended for Fernandes, and Fernandes was in the clear.
Would have had the touchdown.
There's no, somebody run a wrong pattern. You don't run a pulse pattern behind a guy that's running a hook. Now somebody's wrong, and Fernandes was open.
Unless you run it deep behind.
Oh, yeah, you better be real deep.
So it's second and 10. 2:34 the time remaining. 33-17 the score in favor of Montreal. Lobbed into the end zone, almost picked off. Harry Skipper was there.
That was great coverage. Skipper had great coverage on him there. But he just got inside out position the way a good cornerback's supposed to. And they tried to just lay it up over his head and they couldn't do it. Skipper's right here. All they call this is a fade where the receiver just goes down that sideline. You just try to throw it away from him and let him go get it. But watch the position that Harry Skipper has on him. Right inside, and he turns at the right time. He's in better position to catch it than the receiver.
So a third down gamble now for the BC Lions. DeWalt looking into the end zone. Incomplete, intended for Robinson. The BC quarterback did a good job to get away from the pressure. He had Robinson open in the end zone. It may have been deflected down in that goal area.
I don't know that it was deflected, but I think a hand up in the air blinded him momentarily. May have been touched, though.
Well, if anybody touched it, it had to be Preston Young, a safety man. But boy, I'll tell you, DeWalt did do a good job of stepping away from trouble. Let's take
a
look at
it right
here.
He's
a bit trapped. Fakes it and steps up, and you see number 16, the ball's on its way.
Well, I don't think
no,
he touched
it. No, it wasn't. He just didn't catch it.
He just didn't. The hand got in front of him and blinded him momentarily, and it went right between the hands. Just wasn't a question of
this
touching.
This was a run.
Turner Gill trying to stay in bounds, and he gets the first down out to the 31-yard line.
There's been just a couple wrinkles that you've got to give the coaching staff of the Concord credit for that have turned this whole ball game around. One's the option play and one's the rollout by the quarterback with the run. It's no option at all. It's just a definite run with linemen pulling in front of them. And these two plays have meant a lot. Here it comes right now.
Well, you see the receiver outside already.
He's blocking.
Yeah, now watch
no
him. He steps
He's
inside.
Running.
That's a good run.
That's rollout right quarterback pass, rollout right quarterback run, and that was run.
Turner Gill this afternoon has run for 88 yards. Terry Lyman running inside, and he has about seven more. And now 1:50 is the time remaining. Well, the Montreal Concorde are going to take over sole possession of second place in the Eastern Conference with this victory. It could be a costly loss for the BC Lions in their attempts to finish first in the Western Conference, because now they drop back into a tie with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, or remain in a tie with Winnipeg, and of course Winnipeg has the game with the Hamilton Tiger Cats.
Here he goes again.
That's definitely a run there too.
And he's got another first down. Kevin Konar came over to make the tackle. Well, the Montreal Concorde will certainly get a lift from this one, and they'll need it because they take on the Winnipeg Blue Bombers right here at Olympic Stadium next weekend.
Well, I think this is an offense that's more to Turner Gill's liking. He's an excellent athlete. He runs well, and when he's running well, he can throw well because he puts a little bit of pressure on that secondary.
Well, Leo, you called the shot again in our pregame setup. He said the key would be the play of the rookie quarterbacks, Turner Gill and Steve Smith, if in fact Gill had some problems. He hasn't had those problems.
Well, I attribute his success this afternoon again to the new wrinkles that were put into the offense. That's been a great advantage to him, but with the young quarterbacks like Turner Gill and Steve Smith, consistency is the important thing. And they're predictably unpredictable. Against Hamilton just a couple weeks back, they looked about as bad as they could possibly look. Today, they look as good as they could possibly look. They've got to get consistency before this team can make it in the playoffs, Ron.
Yeah, that's for sure. Consistency is the key.
40 seconds remaining as Terry Lyman runs the football up to the 53-yard line. And there's the indication from Miles Doral that they're about a yard short of a first down.
Well, Tyrone Cruz made a great play on that, or he's going to get a lot of yards.
37 seconds remaining. Last week, or 2 weeks ago, I should say, in the last game against the Hamilton Tiger Cats, the quarterbacks did not run the football, which Joe Gallant wanted them to do. And I'm sure in the 2 weeks since that last game, they had the break, of course, on the schedule, that Gallant has been stressing the importance of running that football.
Well, I think what he was doing in the previous games, he had the option to run there off of a pass play. He took it away from him, and it's a designed run. There's no receivers. You don't give them much choice then. There's no one to throw it to.
Well, the fans react unfavorably. They thought on third and one that the Concorde should have been gambling, but I agree with that call by Gallant. You send in the punting unit, and McGrath used up more than the allotted 20 seconds for a time count violation.
Time count violation. Montreal number 3.
Well, when you talk about a performance out here this afternoon, Gill has run 16 times for 93 yards, almost got to that 100 yards, and on his passing, he's 17 for 25 for 161 yards. That's a real afternoon for the rookie.
Third down punt by McGrath. Taken by Darnell Clash, and he's forced out of bounds by Aaron Hill. So we have just 5 seconds remaining, and the Montreal Concorde are going to move into sole possession of second place in the Eastern Conference, and they'll also have a game in hand on the Ottawa Roughriders. And it's a very happy group at that Montreal Concorde bench. Head coach Joe Gallant grinning from ear to ear, and well, he should. He came into this one with a good game plan. His quarterbacks executed it, and the Montreal Concorde now have a leg up in the chase for second place in the Eastern Conference. DeWalt throwing to the sidelines. Fernandez makes the catch at the 31-yard line, but just 1 second remains on the clock. The BC Lions head home to take on the Saskatchewan Roughriders next Saturday, and the Montreal Concorde will be here at Olympic Stadium to face the Winnipeg Blue Bombers next Saturday afternoon. Mervin Fernandez on the sidelines, incomplete, and that's the ball game. A big win for the Montreal Concord as they defeat the British Columbia Lions 33-17. Coming from behind, a 14-3 first quarter deficit to win this one. And they did it with a strong performance, particularly to start the third quarter, where they took the opening kickoff, controlled the ball for almost 8 minutes in marching it in 13 plays for a major score for the go-ahead points. 33-17, Montreal beats British Columbia.
Parkinson's disease can make an adult more helpless than a child. It hits one in every 200 Canadians over the age of 40. If you think it could be you or someone in your family, contact the Parkinson Foundation for help.
And now, let's meet the outstanding players in today's game and winners of the portable Citizen TVs. The Carling O'Keefe Sports Game Stars.
And Turner Gill is the Carling O'Keefe Offensive Game Star. Harry Skipper, the Defensive Game Star. But let's talk to the man who directed this Montreal Concord offense, Turner Gill. Turner, early in the ball game, you seem to have a few problems, but you stuck with the game plan, it appeared, and with that rollout action, you were able to put points on the board.
Well, yeah, you know, they got a good defense, and I just wanted to complete passes. That was the whole key in the game. Just wanted to complete as many passes as we could and try to get the first down.
Turner, were you concerned today that on the option pass, they took it away from you? It was a run all the way with those guards in front of you. Do you feel more at ease with that?
Well, yeah, you know, we want me to get outside and, you know, pressure the defense, whether I'm going to run or throw the ball, and we were successful today.
Turner, I saw you a couple weeks ago against Hamilton, and it was a very frustrating evening for you, and it just didn't look like you had the tools to work with. But today, with that rollout run that you had, with the option play that you had, and then with that variation of your inside attack with the running game, it looked like you had plenty of tools to make it work.
Well, yeah, you know, we finally got everything going. We know, I think the last couple of games we haven't been completing passing, and that's been frustrating to me and to the whole offense. And today we just kind of cut down our pass patterns and, you know, just get the 6 and 7 yard gains and just keep on, you know, roll out and get the first down as best I could.
Turner, on that touchdown pass to Nick Araki to start the third quarter on that third down gamble, I think that was designed initially as a run, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. You know, I tried to get outside, but then I just looked back and saw Nick in the open, so I just jumped the ball to him and he made a good adjustment.
Congratulations, Turner Gill, on being chosen our Carling O'Keefe Offensive Game Star and on your victory. Now let's move over to the man who did a fine job defensively, Harry Skipper, at his cornerback position. You had the task, Harry, this afternoon of covering Mervin Fernandez.
Yeah, all week we worked real hard on just taking away, well, mainly taking Fernandez out of the game. And we put together a couple of coverages, and I think it worked pretty well.
Harry, it looked like today you were mad at somebody. Every time they caught a pass in your territory, you really unloaded on them. Is that normal for you? You like to do that?
Well, you know, I was already up for the game, but during pregame warm-up, you know, those guys were, like, just laughing and kidding around. You know, like, this was going to be a cakewalk for them.
Well, they found out differently, didn't they?
That was a little bit like when you were in college, when you were a Gamecock in South Carolina playing against Clemson, wasn't it, Harry?
Yep, that's right.
Harry, early in the ball game, you put a big hit on John Pankratz on the sidelines. And later on in the ball game, you had one on Fernandez and another on Ned Armour. And then late in the ball game, you had great position when the BC Lions attempted to lob that pass into the end zone to Fernandez.
Yeah, well, last year, playing against Fernandez, he just gave me a lot of problems. Usually, when he run a pattern against me and throw the ball, you know, most of the time he got it.
Well, I'll tell you this, Harry. Last year he got you, but today you got him. So I'd say out of the two games, you're even now, right?
Yeah, I was just trying to work on keeping up from getting the ball.
Well, Harry, on that play-action pass down there on the goal line when they hit John Henry White in there, were you guys in man-for-man or were you in zone? Because I saw you take one step toward the backfield and say, uh-oh, there he goes.
Yeah, well, usually when the corner's coming hard for the, you know, for the sweep or pitch or whatever they do, but that time, you know, John Henry stepped towards me, and then he cut it up. So usually, yeah, I suppose I have him, but I thought he was going to run the option, and he cut back in and went off a pass.
Well, Harry, you've got another big one next week against the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
Yeah, I think we owe them one.
Well, the Winnipeg Blue Bombers are the visitors next week. It came through with a big win today, 33-17 over the British Columbia Lions. And from the Montreal Concorde, our Carling O'Keefe offensive and defensive game stars, quarterback Turner Gill and cornerback Kerry Skipper. The executive producer of CFL football on CBC television is Bob Moyer. Today's game was directed by Ron Harrison. Our isolation director, Mo Waters, and our thanks to statistician Ed Milliken and spotter Art Darch for their help, not only today, but throughout the season. And the other members of our CBC production and technical crew who make CFL football possible on CBC television. Final score, the Montreal Concorde defeating the British Columbia Lions by a score of 33-17 to move into sole possession of second place in the Eastern Conference. And now to CFL Control and Brian Williams.
Thank you, Don. There is only one game in the CFL tomorrow afternoon, the Saskatchewan Rough Riders and the Argonauts from Exhibition Stadium in Toronto. Of course, with Calgary winning over Ottawa Friday, the Western Riders trail the Stampeders by 5. They need a win. Toronto has all but wrapped up first place in the Eastern Conference. Speaking of Saskatchewan, our next telecast, 1 week from tonight, the Rough Riders and the Lions from BC Place in Vancouver. For all of us at CBC Sports, I'm Brian Williams. So long, everyone, from CFL Control.